1.
No one can stop me now.
Here he is, the godfather of sports radio. Here's Tony Bruno.
Good afternoon, everybody. It is Monday, the 18th of March. Hope you got over your St. Patrick's Day drink fest. And I can report exclusively at this hour that Robin and I did not have one single sip of alcohol the entire St. Patty's weekend, even though Miss Robin has been identified, self-identified as Shanty Irish from back in the day.
I'm not a shanty Irish. I am a lace Irish.
Lace Irish?
Wasn't that what somebody said?
I don't know.
Table lace Irish or something like that?
I'm not the one who determines what nationality and what your proclivities are. Everybody was Irish over the weekend, Robin. That's the one thing about St. Patrick's Day. If there's a bar around, you're Irish. And, you know, and listen, let's be
curtain
honest.
Curtain lace Irish.
Yeah. But let's be honest. Isn't it kind of sad that when people think of the Irish, what's the thing first thing they think about?
Drunkenness.
Drinking beer. Dying beer.
Whiskey.
Whiskey. Boilermakers. Now, that's the Polish. But when you have a nationality.
Irish
and you know
car
what's
bomb.
Great about, you know what's great about the Irish? They don't get triggered when you tell them that they like to drink.
They're like, yeah, so?
Yeah, pour me another one. Pour me a Guinness, will you? Anyway, as you can hear in the background, let me be the 1,000th person. Since Sunday evening, when they drew the brackets. You know I love me some brackets, Robin. Crank this up, because I'm thinking, we're dancing, baby, we're dancing. And I do my tribute to the great Dick Vitale, who's still recovering from throat issues. We dancing, as they say, Robin. In the NCAA, the NIT, you down with NIT, you have your bracketology. The bubble shit's all over, and Joe Lenardi summed it up. Last night on Sunday night, St. Patrick's Day, I'm sure he wasn't drinking because he's Italian, but I'm sure he was a guy who needed to drink because I have never seen Joe Lenardi, the ESPN bracketologist guy who has the bubble teams in, the first four out. At the end of yesterday, he just said, that's it. I'm done. I quit. That's what he tweeted. I quit. Because there were so many games and so many conference championship games. And then if you were a degenerate gambler like I am, but I didn't bet on anything. We were too busy out on the lot making sure we get our house started. But all the favorites, all the top seeds going into the tournament found ways to lose, yet they're still top seeds in the tournament. So what do we draw from that? We draw from that is that, you know, the good team, UConn, wasn't going to get knocked out of a one seed, even if they had lost yesterday. And the other one seed, some teams got punished. But let's be honest, ladies and gentlemen, when you look at your brackets, my bracket's over here, Robin, I didn't pull it off the printer. Did you? Can you? Let me see if I can slide back enough to pull it off the printer. I'm locked in here now, Robin.
Here, I can do it.
Can you grab it off the printer? I got my brackets. I haven't filled them out. I'm not giving out picks and all that other stuff until later. But everybody's going to become a gambling expert this week. People who couldn't name one player on any of these teams will suddenly become armchair, bar chair, experts in men's college basketball, ladies and gentlemen. Did you enter your bracket yet? I like when my bracket doesn't get busted. I prefer bras getting busted. Those brackets that hold bras together, Robin. And if you're a woman and your bracket's busted, that means you need to get a bigger bra or just let those babies breathe. One of the two things, Robin. Now,
I'm a woman, for letting them breathe. Yeah. That is my choice.
Let those puppies breathe, baby! Joe Quills checks it. My brackets are still perfect. Not one drop of ink or a hint of pencil on my brackets yet. She removes the dishes in the sink before pissing.
Yeah, that's
Is that what that means?
So just to remind.
Let's recap St. Patrick's Day.
Shanty Irish.
Right, Shanty.
The difference between Shanty Irish and Curtain Irish. The lace Curtain Irish remove the dishes from the sink before they pee in it.
Okay. Is that now written somewhere? So let it be written, so let it be said.
It's one of those,
Shanty,
you know,
Irish, like, people pee in the sink?
That's what.
Now remember, when
John
I was growing up, when I was growing up in Philly, and Veterans Stadium was the old dilapidated, but it was new and improved back in 71. I was there when it opened in 71. It has now been gone for like 20 years. But back in those days, you know, the men's room, guys would all, and men, guys do this anyway, and women do it too. They go to a sporting event, they drink a lot. Even if you don't, you got to go pee. And I remember going into Veterans Stadium, and they had, the sinks were like one long thing. And when you couldn't get, you know, you were like 20 deep in front of a urinal back in those days. And what did guys do? They stood in line to pee in the sinks. What are you going to do, pee on the floor? No, you pee in the sink. So I don't understand why peeing in the sink now all of a sudden has become a derogatory term for so-called shanty Irish people who pee in the sink. You only pee in the sink when you have to. Like when I have to pee, I just go outside and pee wherever I am. Not on somebody's property, but I'll, you know, we're on the lot yesterday, right? Mm-hmm. It's open space, it's grass, there's a lot of flies. So I was afraid if I took my, if I, you know, squeezed one out. Well, you don't squeeze out urine.
No.
That's something else. And I would never do that on my lot. That's consecrated ground now. You take it out and you pee. That's the advantage that men have, Robin.
Yes, they do.
So when I said, you, I got to pee, just... I didn't go look for a tree because there was nobody around. And if nobody's around and you pee, does anybody see it? That's the big question. You know what I'm saying?
Well, if... We're hoping that nobody sees it because you could get in trouble for that. But women have it, you know, men have it so much easier.
No, I saw a video yesterday, Robin, and I got to send it to you. It was a woman outside of a car somewhere. I don't know if it was in the United States. Did you see this one? And she's leaning over on the passenger side talking to a guy. I suspect she may have been a working lady. So she's talking to the guy. As she's leaning over, she is peeing standing up, but she's hunched over. And that stream was strong, and nobody crossed that stream. I forgot to say, but you know, I don't know if you're going to find it. It was a random Twitter feed, and it was a woman peeing, not standing up, but hunched over. So don't give me any of these crap, ladies, that you can't pee standing up. Women can, in fact, pee standing up, Robin, especially if you're not wearing any pants.
They can. It's
because you don't, you know, men have pants on. Men have pants on, so for them to pee, they got to unzip it or take their pants down. But when a woman has a dress on and she's not wearing any panties, all she's got to do is pull that skirt up, bend over, and boom. Let it run. Let it stream.
But it's messy.
You know what? I got to show you. I got to find that video. I won't find it now because I ran into it by accident going through all the crazy stuff on Twitter today. And by the way, there will be no bloodbath on this show today. So I got the word bloodbath out of my way because, you know, that's the word of the day, I guess. Bloodbath, Robin. You know what's interesting about the word bloodbath?
There hasn't been a bloodbath here for a really long time.
No. There was yesterday when I was getting stung by those greenhead flies. And, of course, I have to make a list when we go out to the lot because we're building our home. You know, there's a lot of things. But one of the things we've been noticing, it's been nice and breezy. So when there's a nice breeze, you don't get flies coming around.
Yeah.
But now that the temperature is hitting 90 here in Florida, and that's what the scheduled high is today. Do you have the actual local, the temperature right now, Robin? Let me see what the temperature is here in Cape Coral, Florida on this March 18th.
I believe that it is 70.
There's no way it's in the 70s, Robin.
Yeah.
They were saying 90 degrees today.
I think that they miscalculated.
They didn't. Listen, the weather people are off a lot, but not by 17 degrees because it's been hot. It's been in the 80s. It feels warmer. The humidity's building up. It's almost hurricane season, and that's what we do here. But anyway, it's hot. It's sticky. And when there's no breeze, the bugs come. So I make my little list here. I got the trailer hitch, which we took so we can move our boat trailer so they can
84.
Start. 84? Mm-hmm. But it feels like 90. What's the humidity, Robin? It's hot out there, hot and sticky, the way nobody likes it. Trailer hitch, jack, shovels, and we bought our own shovels the other day because we left all of our tools back in New Jersey. So we're going out. We have to break ground on our new lot. Got no shovels. We had no trash bags. We had no twine. We had no trailer lock key so we can unlock the trailer and move it so the dirt can be delivered. And most importantly, yesterday, the biggest thing we forgot, insect repellent. We had sunscreen, but no insects. So you got to make sure your plan when you're doing stuff, make a plan, make a list, and check it twice. So anyway, We got all kinds of stuff. We'll get to the NCAA tournament. We got NBA news. We got NFL news. We got golf news, baseball. Dodgers and the Padres are in Seoul, South Korea. They'll be playing a couple of days starting on Wednesday of this week. Of course, tomorrow, Tuesday the 19th, is officially the first day of spring, Robin. And the good news, it looks like spring is sprung on most of the country. Now, in some places, it's still cold up in the mountains, and they're still getting some snow here and there. But for the most part, we can all be happy that winter is over and spring is here. Here in Florida, spring lasts about a week, and now we're going into summer already. It's March 18th, and it is hot as summer, but not as hot as it's going to be. But you know how that works. It's not the heat. It's the stupidity that gets you all the time. Meanwhile, so we got a lot of people complaining. One thing about college sports, and we do it in all sports, football fans complain, basketball fans and coaches complain about officiating. People always complain in sports. Soccer, you know, there's riots in Turkey when the wrong team wins. Did you see that over the weekend in Turkey?
Yes.
They don't play that shit, Robin. When their team loses in Turkey and some of these other countries, they just don't sit back on their hands and say, oh, we'll get them next time. We got to find some of that video. That is unbelievable. What's up with the Turks, man? Not the Turks and Caicos. They're beautiful. But the Mad Turks, the Young Turks, like that that slimy Mad Turk guy, Young Turk. What's his name? Not Spiro Dedis. He's a great Turk.
Yeah.
No, he's not even a Turk. He's a Greek. Anyway, the Turks, they're kind of wacky. So stay away from Turkish soccer games if you don't want to get into the middle of a brawl. You know what I'm saying, Robin? Cool. Meanwhile, we've got all kinds of stuff going on, including football. And we'll get to that. The Dallas Cowboys had to tweak a contract today for Dak Prescott because they're still trying to work out a deal with Dak, but they owe him like $60 million this year. And so they're so far over the cap that they asked Dak Prescott to basically take a $5 million hit. And that means they're not going to take $5 million away from him. They're going to pay him a $5 million bonus right now. And so that will basically count as part of the $60 million they owe him. But then that will give him some cap relief because now he'll be a $55 million quarterback going into the last year of his contract. So that bonus has been converted into a signing bonus, and the cap hit has been reduced by $4 million. Don't ask me to do the math because this is not a show about math. So it's now over $55 million, and they can create more salary cap relief with an extension for Prescott, who's coming off a wild card loss at home. And you know that is playoff record if you're scoring at home, Cowboy fans, and I know you're not, just like the Cowboys aren't in the postseason. Dallas Cowboys with their win at loss to Green Bay, Dak Prescott's playoff record, 2-5. 2-5. Now, supposedly they're trying to get Dak extended. Jerry Jones has said they're going to try to keep him. But it doesn't seem as dead set on getting this deal done as soon as possible like he was last year, remember? I mean, he took another cap. He had another cap situation the last time. So the Cowboys have been really, really quiet, like the rascally wabbit. Remember when Elmer Fudd said, be really, really quiet?
Yes.
I'm hunting for wabbits. Not Dak Prescott. But anyway, they still have to pay CeeDee Lamb. They got to pay Micah Parsons. And they got to pay the Piper when it comes to the National Football League. You should know what the NFL stands for, Robin. Not for long if you suck in the playoffs. There's your quick NFL update. But we got a lot of stuff going on, too. People are still crying about the Justin Fields thing. Kenny Pickett, who was the Sixers, the Eagles sign. Now Eagle fans are like, wait a minute. We gave up all of that to get Kenny Pickett when Justin Fields was traded from the Chicago Bears to Pittsburgh for far less? What is going on back there? So Kenny Pickett's an Eagle. He had a news conference today where he said, you know, this is where he wants to play. It's his hometown. Now the Eagle fans are like, why do we pay all this guy to hold a clipboard? Because that's why you pay a backup quarterback. Now Pittsburgh has two quarterbacks, and they're going to have to figure out what to do there too. But that's not my problem. I don't worry about that stuff. And of course, the Cowboys lost one of their great offensive linemen over the weekend. Tyron Smith signs a one-year deal. It was Friday night, actually. And I just got paid, and I had to go out and didn't really care after that. 1-year contract could be worth up to $20 million with incentives. And Aaron Rodgers coming back from the Achilles will now have a new look line in front of him. The Jets adding three starters, Smith, left guard John Simpson, and right tackle Morgan Moses. So you know they had to worry. And the best part for Aaron Rodgers, he doesn't have to worry about being vice president behind RFK. Because that was the big story. Remember last, Aaron Rodgers is going to be the vice president under RFK Jr. Not so fast, my friends. He then decided on some chick no one's ever heard of, but she looks hot, Robin. I don't know. Did you see the woman that he picked? RFK Jr.?
Let me see.
Come on, Robin. How can you not be all over that, being a woman yourself, and you identify, and you are proud to be a woman, I believe, right? The last time I checked?
I am pretty proud that I'm a woman, yes.
Do you have to...
I'm not...
Do women say, I'm a woman, hear me roar anymore? Or will they be criticized as being cisgendered white men, white women? I don't talk about that stuff because I don't understand it. I know I'm a man and Robin's a woman. That's all that matters on this program.
Nicole Shanahan.
She's a lawyer, right? Can you give me a little on Nicole Shanahan? And let me buy this, by the way. If you put her picture up, the answer is would.
You know who was there yesterday or over the weekend was Matt Fowler. He went to Oakland to watch.
You mean Matt Fowler from the LFG show?
LFG show.
He did a road trip and became a political correspondent for a day?
Yes.
So remember, that was the big story that RFK Jr. was going to go to Oakland to make his announcement on who the vice president would be, his choice. And I jokingly said, you know, when I think of Oakland, I think of MC Hammer. Remember, MC Hammer was a ball boy for the Oakland A's back in the day, right? And when you're thinking about Oakland and Oaktown, you think about the Raiders, and then you think about MC Hammer. Hammer time!
The only thing, I mean, I remember MC Hammer, obviously, and his music. There's two things that I know about MC Hammer having lived in the Bay Area. One, when I was working for the airline as a gate agent, he drove a hammer, a Hummer.
And a Hummer?
His license plate was Hammer's Hummer. And he was late for a flight and jumped out of his Hummer, parked it where you're not supposed to park, you know, where now police make you leave.
Yep.
And then he threw the keys at one of the belt, like the luggage people.
The valet, yeah.
Not even valet. It was just some random person that was working at one of the airlines, not ours, but and said, I'll pay you later. Park this. And then just like went onto his flight. That was my one. And he went off running. And then the other one was that right around the corner from where we lived, he started his congregation.
Yeah, he became an ordained minister just like Tony Bruno. But by the way, Robin, I'm sorry. I got to play this right now.
Okay.
I got to play a little MC Hammer. I know I got to get this stupid thing out of the way first.
Okay.
Hammer time!
I will raise it as soon as that video is over.
Let me mute it and then pass it, because I got to play this, Robin. I mean, let's be honest.
You don't need to mute it. Just.
Okay, I got to play it now. I got to mute it.
Through this.
I got it right now, these stinking commercials. Anyway.
See, if you let me do it, I have no commercials.
You didn't have it pulled. I had you pull Come Dancing, a great classic, you know, because it's, you know, it's March Madness officially now. Come dancing.
Aaron Michael on social media saying, what a great show. Why, thank you. Speaking of which, this is your little reminder. Please do us a favor and
share the show.
Like the show. Comment on the show inside the social media. It helps the algorithms. Mm-hmm. But what's even better than just hitting retweet if you're on X is quote tweet. Quote tweet it. Show your interest, show your love, tell everybody to tune into us live.
Exactly. Now, let's go back to the American Music Awards for this big announcement.
Why do we want to do this?
Because I want to play the song. MC Hammer. That's when he won the favorite rap artist, Robin. You remember that night?
You can't touch this.
Yeah. Oh, man.
You can't touch this.
I got to get my parachute pants on, Robin. Can't touch this. There's a guy somewhere who's like a local DJ. Did you see? He's like a street performer. He's an old dude.
Yeah.
And he's up on a stage, and he's doing this exactly the same as MC Hammer.
That's impressive.
I saved that over the weekend, and I forgot to post it. We got to post that one, because this guy is incredible. Crank it up. I mean, this has got to be top 25 greatest songs of all time when it comes to hip-hop and R&B.
Yes.
Can't touch this, homeboy. Crank it up, brother.
You can't touch this.
Tony, I was showing people the video, and you just went off of it.
Oh, okay, that's all right.
See, this is why you can't do this.
No, let me do it, Robin. I control the horizontal and vertical. This is like the Twilight Zone. No, this is. Yeah.
God.
For the next 3 hours, we will be in control of all you see and hear here.
Let's get back to the other question you asked of me. Nicole Shanahan. Is a California attorney and entrepreneur previously married to Google co-founder Sergey Brin.
Mm-hmm.
And she is known for paying for Kennedy's Super Bowl commercial and is expected to be formally named as the vice presidential candidate.
So pushed that because she was married to a Google dude who obviously was richer than hell, right?
Oh, yeah.
So then she used the money from her, is it her ex-husband?
Ex-husband.
So she took whatever she got from the divorce settlement, and I'm just thinking out loud.
You're just conjecturing.
I'm assuming
yes.
that since she got divorced from a Google executive, she got a nice, lovely parting gift, but she's an attorney, so she's a successful woman who probably has a great practice and makes money as well. And then she says, I'm going to pay for your Super Bowl commercial, RFK Jr. What say I put the bill for that, and then you make me the vice president? And he said, what the hell? Why am I going to do Aaron Rodgers? Or who was the other guy, the former governor of Minnesota? Remember, they were the two names that were floating out there, and then I knew neither one of those guys was from Oakland. Now, of course, Aaron Rodgers grew up in the Bay Area, but not in Oakland. He was more of a Stanford Cal guy. He was a Cal guy, that's right. In Berkeley. That's not Oakland. That's near Oakland, but it ain't Oakland, Robin. And you know the difference between Oakland and Berkeley. You know what I'm saying?
I do.
About $5 million a home, I think. That's the difference. Unless you're in the Oakland Hills, then it's expensive up there. Your little Bay Area knowledge right here. Yes, Jesse the Body Ventura. No, you didn't see. I did not open the browser's tab. Come on, man. Come on. By the way, our buddy Rick Marcus just checking in. He's up at the Phillies game in Clearwater today as we start winding down spring training. And apparently the Phillies have gone into, let's get the hell out of here and go home mode. Right now, Phillies and Pittsburgh Pirates, and the Pirates are laying a biblical beatdown on the fighting Phillies. It is 11-2 Pittsburgh. What is going on up there? So the Pirates and the Phillies, final week and a half or so baseball. Phillies open it up on next Thursday, the 28th. So we only have a few games left in spring training. And people come down to Clearwater as we did last week. We went up there, and it's a fun time. And we saw the Phillies get smoked by and give up 13 runs on a Saturday afternoon game. So you're really not going to spring training to watch your team win, even though they do still do the seventh inning stretch and play, let's root for the home team. You know what people are rooting for in the seventh inning of a spring training game, Robin? Let's root for the tiki bar. If they run out of rum, it's a shame. Cause it's 1-2.
And I think
three drinks are out at the old ball game.
I think that they did kind of run out of rum because we had
last week they ran out of rum.
When we had our first drink, it was nice and strong, and it tasted like coconut rum. We had it was concoction they were offering. And then we wanted to have another one afterwards, and there was no rum in that.
You're
sucker.
Damn right. You're at, and we paid full price.
Yes.
We paid for the full rum experience. And
it was an outrage.
It was a weak pour. Harry Mays were there. You know how pissed off he would be?
They
didn't lower the price.
No.
It's like $13 for a little drink.
And
then you're going to give us one of those pours? I have to give them one of those, Robin. And it's not my style. Give me my $13 worth, Bo. Meanwhile, let's get it back to...
Now, Tony, I cannot find the Bruce Pearl, Peter Burns
I know, because
video.
It was... See, when you go to ESPN and I'm looking at all the great videos... So let's get it back to the NCAA tournament here. Because obviously... You know, we've got the teams in. Team people are complaining. A lot of teams who didn't make it are going to the NIT, which used to stand for the Not Important Tournament. And there are some legitimate guys who are pissed off. Rick Pitino, let's be honest. We made fun of him when he criticized his team. Then they came out and played like hell down the stretch. They get all the way to the championship game of the Big East. And they lose. And then he pointed out this one. Because, you know, there's all these. There's BPI. Then there's NET. And these are all bullshit analytic things that they put up there to make it look like they really give a shit and they're picking teams based. Let's be honest. They got jobbed. St. John's got jobbed. And I'm going to give Rick Pitino credit for saying, screw you, NIT. I'm not going there. Because you realize if Rick Pitino's team had made the tournament, that would have been the sixth different team that he's taken in his career to the NCAA Big Dance. And so then there's other people who are critical of these teams that didn't make the tournament and decided not to go to the NIT. 20 win teams, three of them in the Big East, got screwed. St. John's, Providence, and Seton Hall. And another team that got screwed because the Big 12 had eight teams in. Remember, the Big East only had three teams in. The Big 12 had eight teams in, and they still screwed over a 28-win Oklahoma team. And then they'll use all these analytics and all this other bullshit. And then Tom Crean went on ESPN yesterday, and a lot of people are saying, yes, he's right. I'm one of those who says, no, I'm saying screw you, NIT. If my team gets jobbed in the NCAA tournament, screw you. Let's go to Tom Crean. This is him after the NIT selection show was announced on ESPN, and he said those coaches and those players are hurting themselves.
There's no question about it. I would want to coach. I would want to develop my team. You've got bigger staffs than you've ever had. There's plenty of time for the portal. There's plenty of time to talk to recruits. There's plenty of time to negotiate NIL deals. There's not plenty of time to play. There's not plenty of time to get your players on the floor and give them a chance to get better. There's not plenty of time for guys to continue to play that may never get to play again. Mm-hmm. And that, to me, is absolutely ridiculous. It's each coach's choice. I get it. But if you take away a chance to play the games, to put your team on the floor, let them opt out. All right, the bowl season has it all the time. Let it happen. Who cares? Give your players and coaches a chance to keep coaching and playing, wow, and don't shortchange. If a guy doesn't want to play, go sit down. If a coach doesn't want to coach, go recruit. But there's got to be enough people to put five, six, seven people on the floor and go play. It makes absolutely zero sense to me.
Now, some people, and I hear what he's saying to a certain extent, but do you think these kids who just spent an entire season, you know, want to go and play another game that doesn't really matter? You know, I mean, NIT batters. Remember, before there was the NCAA tournament, the NIT was the big tournament. And then after a long time, it became the not important tournament. And so a lot of these coaches figure, you know what? My kids just played a whole season. Playing one more game is going to make a difference to them. They're going to make more money by playing a game on a Wednesday night that nobody's watching? That's the part I don't understand. I get, yeah, kids will get another game in. But let's look at what's happening in football. These kids who are top recruits in the NFL, they don't even want to play in their bowl games. They don't even want to go to the combine. They don't even want to show teams how they run, how they throw. And so screw that. The players can do whatever they want now. And so why should they be forced to go play another game? And this whole thing about, well, if my team goes to the NIT and the star player doesn't want to play, just have him sit down. Then how is that fair to the rest of the team or the fans or the people paying money to go watch these teams on the NIT? So it's one of those interesting arguments. I can see both sides of it, but I disagree. If I'm St. John's, if I'm Rick Pitino, I'm saying screw you to the NIT, okay? Now, another team that got screwed, our own Pete Sheppard's Providence Friars, and I give their coach credit. Their coach, Kim English, said, analytics are bullshit, and he's absolutely right. Bullshit. It's an absolute thing that everybody must be saying.
Bullshit.
Bullshit.
It's all bullshit.
It is all bullshit. And props to Kim English from your Providence Friars. How the hell did they not get in? How the hell did Seton Hall? Well, Seton Hall is going to the Big Ten. They didn't get in either. But Seton Hall is going to the NIT. And we have the matchups. And listen, you want to watch the NIT? I know degenerate gamblers who can't wait till Thursday for the tournament to start at like 9 o'clock in the morning will have plenty to bet on Tuesday and Wednesday nights when they play these NIT games, and it'll start. And for teams like Villanova that didn't make it, you know, they'll play at home. So the NIT teams will play on their home floor, those who get the home floor advantage. And for Villanova fans, you know, they weren't expected to do a lot of things this year, so they're going to go home and watch Villanova, the Wildcats, play against VCU on Wednesday night. St. Joe's against UCF. St. Joe's is going to be playing. No, St. Joe's is going to be playing not against UCF. UCF, which is now in the Big 12, they got left out. They're going to be playing South Florida Wednesday in Orlando, and these teams used to be in the same conference in the AAC. So UCF doesn't make the tournament. They make the they settle for going to the NIT, and they'll play on Wednesday night in Orlando. And then Ohio State will host Cornell on Tuesday. Now, if you're an Ohio State fan, you fired your coach, you make an amazing run with the backup coach, and then you say, sorry, you're not getting into the NCAA tournament, but how about this for a consolation prize? How about all you kids out there in Columbus, Ohio? How about you go down there and watch an Ivy League team play Ohio State? And listen, I don't hate the Ivy League, but you think fans at Ohio, at Columbus, Ohio, Lily's jumped up. She's excited about the play-in games. Anyway, so they'll play, who else? Indiana State with the great talent himself. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. His team didn't make the NCAA tournament, but he'll don those glasses again, and he will play. Aren't they going? Yeah, Indiana State. Indiana State is in there, and they will play SMU on Wednesday night. So all of you Kareem Abdul-Jabbar fans up there in Indiana, you'll get to see him one more time. Wake Forest, another good team, is in the NIT. They'll play Appalachian State. And St. Joe's, the Owls, who had a great run, and we'll have Phil Martelli will be on with us tomorrow. Of course, he's not at St. John's, and he hasn't been for a while, but Phil Martelli will talk about NIT, NCAA tournaments, Michigan, and all the stuff he's going through, and his son, who's a coach as well. So St. Joe's, the Hawks will play Seton Hall, and Villanova will play VCU. Temple did not make it. And I don't know if Temple, I guess Temple made it, yeah. I didn't even look at the brackets. Who would have thought that Temple would be the only team in the Philadelphia so-called Big Five or Big Six? And I don't even know where they're playing, because I haven't even looked at the stinking thing yet, Robin. I don't see them on here.
Wayne Atkinson saying, Lily's going to go with the Cats to win it all.
Yes, she is. The Villanova, that's a sign right there. If you're a Villanova fan, lay the lumber, Villanova at home against VCU. And I believe VCU gave them some trouble when they played earlier this year. So I'm looking at my brackets. I'm not going to fill them out until a couple of days from now when I have a couple cocktails, sit back, relax, and work on my tan out on the boat, which is still in the dock, so I'm not going anywhere with it, for those of you who think I'm trying to rub it in. But anyway, that's what's going on. And are you ready for the tournament? Bruce Pearl, though, had a good comment, because Bruce Pearl, who did a great job at Auburn, right? I mean, look at poor Florida lost one of their best players early in that game. Auburn wins the SEC. And now Bruce Pearl wasn't complaining. He was laughing about it. Because when you look at the teams that are all being shipped out across the country, a lot of them are East Coast teams. And so in this times of economic downturns, and let's be honest, Auburn football versus Auburn basketball. Now, Charles Barkley played at Auburn. And they've had good teams and tournament teams. And Bruce Pearl has been in a lot of tournaments with different teams. And you know, Bruce Pearl's a funny guy, so he's not bitching about it. But he was talking about how it's unfair, you know, for kids to now all of a sudden get flights and go out west to watch their favorite team playing in a tournament. But that's the way it works. I don't know. I don't know how the committee does it, but just like anything else the NCAA does, they just want to get it out of the way and go put their blazers on and go to the country club and get ready to watch golf. That's what these strappers do. You think they care now that the NCAA tournament field is set? No, they're done. Just like Joe Lunardi. They'll take the rest of the year off. At least Joe Lunardi works his ass off for a couple of months before he takes his ass off and shuts itself down. I wonder what Joe Lunardi is doing today, now that his job is finished here. Does he throw a grenade back into the bracketology bubble room and say, my job is finished.
Done.
I quit. Get me out of here. Now, Timothy Phillip McDermott Sr. says, Nova blows. Their run is done with transfer portal, NIL, and Jay Wright gone. I don't know about that. Villanova still can recruit big-time players. They do all the time, and it's not because Jay. Listen, I love Jay Wright more than any man can love another man without being, you know, a guy who hangs with men. I hang with men. But you know what I'm saying? I'm a heterosexual man. But Jay Wright is a good-looking. Jay Wright's a good-looking man. Let's be honest. And he dresses to the nines.
Yes, he does. It's all about, you know, it's all about the, what do they call that?
I didn't say. Did I just say St. Joe? I call them the Owls. No, the St. Joe Hawks. The Hawk will never die. Phil Martelli coached St. Joe's, I said. I didn't say he coached St. John's. Phil Martelli was a Michigan assistant coach this year.
Right.
And they just fired their head coach, and presumably the entire staff is going to go.
But we don't know that.
But normally when you fire the head coach,
you're
the new coach or the athletic director brings in a new head coach, and then he hires his assistants. So I know where Phil Martelli coached. If I slipped, I apologize.
Joe Quill saying Temple is playing in the California Penal League tourney after shaving points a couple of weeks ago.
Hey, listen, if you can shave points, you can shave your punani, you should shave points. But now that investigation that we talked about a couple of weeks ago, remember?
So what's going on with that?
What do I look like? J. Edgar Hoover?
Yes.
Do I look like Christopher Wray, the FBI director, the CIA director?
Well, I know that you were pulling up an article earlier.
I was watching it, but it didn't have any update. It was basically a rehash of the same story that Temple, and the amazing thing is that when that game happened, and then there was, they're being investigated for point shaving. And then when people went back and everyone, Temple sucked. They wouldn't do that. And then all of a sudden, Temple starts playing well and they get all the way, deep into the playoffs. And they beat a pretty good damn team to advance.
Now, John from Mayfair saying, I think Temple is out.
Yeah, but again, my point is that Temple played great down the stretch and was able to go deep into the tournament, the conference tournament, and lost to a better team. But to me, it's not about, what's Temple going to do in the poll? Are they going to win a national? None of these teams can win a national championship. There's only a couple of teams that can win. Now, we've seen some great upsets, and now everybody's going to be looking at the 4-12 games and all the early upsets. That's how you make money if you're gambling on the NCAA tournament. If you have a pool, if you want to not rip it up after the first weekend. Like a lot of people on Sundays after the first round goes by, and then they get to the second round, at the end of the weekend when they go and get it down and cut it in half, they rip up their pools. They got no shot. And then there'll be that one guy who will say, hey, listen, I still got my Final Four teams intact. That's all I'm worried about right now. No, you're not. If your pool gets wiped out on week one, your chances of winning this whole thing are as good as, I can't even think of something preposterous enough to make that happen. We're going to take a break. We're coming right back. So we will have more breakdowns on this. Of course, the championship game is in Phoenix, Arizona, Robin. The Final Four, baby. The Final Four in Arizona, where it'll be a dry heat when they play on April 8th at the final. How many? And it always goes back to one number, Robin. Not one is the loneliest number.
No.
But the number on this show that always matters.
Always.
Is... what is it?
It's four, but why isn't it playing? Just play it.
There you go. Four. The Final Four. It's all that matters.
But we're still dancing.
Yes, we are. We're the dancing, I don't know about Queen, but I love Queen. But I'm not a dancing queen, Robin. Not that there's anything wrong with that if you want to do that. I do have some, anyway, we'll get back. We're coming right back. You know the number to call, right?
352-234-8669. That's 352-234-TONY.
Gotcha.
You can text and call.
Exactly. We got a lot of good stuff coming up today. We have a Florida update that's beyond belief. We'll have a golf update. We'll do hockey update. We'll do NBA.
We got a Texas
baseball,
update.
Golf, Texas, anything you want. We have it right here on the Tony Bruno Sports Network. Stick around.
It was meant to be. Tony Bruno on the Tony Bruno's.
The earthquake must be stopped. We must make contact.
Reports of flying saucers are nothing new.
These are routine sightings, not isolated events.
Are you seeing that? It's spinning. There's a whole swarm of them.
Oh, my God. They're all against the wind. All against the wind.
Yeah.
Oh, look at this. That's 110, 100 feet.
Today on Capitol Hill, and an unprecedented bipartisan push for UFO transparency.
contact. I told you it's in Broadway. This always happens.
Nice ride.
It's the real deal. 100% electric.
It's the real deal.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Of course. Enjoy your coffee. Careful, it's hot.
Okay, thanks.
Your dog's so cute.
Yeah.
Ooh, so adorable. Yeah, wow. Yeah,
right.
We both know
it's the man. Makes the clothes.
Come on.
You know, you look nice.
Okay, we're done.
Hello, Mr. Walken. Does this table work for you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did someone say yeah?
Don't you got somewhere to be?
Yeah.
Oh.
There's only one Christopher Walken and only one ultimate driving machine. The rest are just imitations.
Come on.
Good afternoon, Sheriff. The usual?
Thanks, Earl.
They're back! The adversaries are back!
Not again.
Sheriff, I got this.
Protecting your business from cyber attacks can be unrelenting. With CrowdStrike, you get AI-powered threat protection, industry-leading intelligence, and a team of experts to detect threats and prevent breaches before they happen. Today's adversaries move fast. CrowdStrike moves faster.
What do you call that?
The future.
CrowdStrike.
Now back to the biggest sports network on the planet, the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
Just reviewing some NBA action over the weekend. Talk about bloodbath. 76ers on Saturday night without Joel Embiid playing in his 21st straight game since he was sidelined and had the surgery. Tyrese Maxey, talk about bloodbaths. Bloodied in the face. Hard elbow to the face. Brandon Miller, flagrant two, out of the game, and they had to plug up his nose. He had two things in his nose, two big wads of stuff in there. That's a bloodbath, Robin, in the NBA. So the 76ers trying to hang in there, but they're a 7 seed right now. I don't know how much better they're going to be, and I'll have to turn the sound off here, Robin. Thank you. But anyway, so while the Sixers go through that, the Philadelphia Flyers are leaking faster than the Titanic. But the big story for the Flyers today is not that they can't beat the Boston Bruins, who have owned them the last couple of years. Not that they have failed in their big stretch of playing, you know, contenders in the 8-game stretch that we talked about when they were winning a couple of games in a row. Now, they can't stop anything. And the guy that they traded away, Sean Walker, had a couple of big goals the other night for his new team. But Wayne Simmonds, earlier this morning, announced he is retiring from the NHL after 15 years, 8 of them with the Flyers. He was in the Stanley Cup playoffs 9 different times. He played, 6 different teams in his career, all-star with the Flyers in 2017. And here's the most remarkable thing about Wayne Simmonds' career, and I saw all of it in Philadelphia. Great, gritty guy. Everybody loved him. He played hard. He was a top draft pick of the Los Angeles Kings, and I remember when the Flyers got him in a trade. The guy came in and was a fan favorite for 8 years. Played hard, but this is a stat that's really startling when you talk about points and goals and assists. Wayne Simmonds, or as we call him, the Simmer, in his 1,037 games, he had 526 points. Not Hall of Fame numbers, but when you look at the 526 points, this is what really stands out. He had 263 goals and 263 assists. You talk about a guy who could distribute and he can put the puck in the net. You will rarely see a guy with 526 points have 263 and 263 goals and assists. You can't be any more of a team player than that. It's unbelievable. I mean, there's guys who have 100-point seasons in a year, you know, and most of it's assists because they score goals too. But now, you know, now the 100-point guys, they can do everything. But Wayne Simmons, back in the muck and grind days when he played with the Flyers, the guy did it all, and that's why the fans loved him, and that's why he announced today he will retire as a Philadelphia Flyer. They signed him to a one-day contract, and on April 13th, they will honor him at the Wells Fargo Center on a special night against the New Jersey Devils.
He is clearly not in Philadelphia when he made
No, he looked like he was down here in Florida with me. We're doing an interview with him live, and he's got the beaches behind him, and I'm saying, where's Wayne Simmons? I could have gone there and done an interview with him.
I know.
And saved the Philadelphia media the time to go in and watch him on a big screen with the palm trees behind him. You know what I'm saying?
Palm trees. There was nice sunshine. It was pretty awesome.
Exactly right.
Hey, Tony.
What did I say, Rob? Did I get something else wrong? I said Wayne Simmons played 137 games.
No.
Okay.
Robert McKenzie says it was 1,037.
No, I'm sorry. 1,037 games. Did I say 137?
I think you did.
1,037. I'm bad with my commas today. Maybe I should have been drinking this weekend.
That might have
I decided
helped.
Not to drink anything because I wanted to focus on stuff. Well, and I didn't have one drink, Robin.
We were out in the sun all day.
I know.
And because we were dehydrated, we both decided it was probably a bad idea. Tony.
I can't turn it off, Robin. Every time I try to bring it up to turn the thing off, it plays a video.
Here.
To me how I'm supposed to fix that.
I'm going to mute it.
I guess I'll bring it down. Okay.
There, that works.
One of these days, Robin, one of these days, I'm not doing the Jackie Gleason. You're going to the moon, Robin. Pow! Right in the kisser. Remember when he used to say
that? Even when you're the one that's doing the wrong thing?
Because I'm the one that has to open and close it. I don't have control where I can turn the volume down and shut it off. You have that control.
No, you can mute the tab.
I don't want to mute the tab because then when I go to play something, the tab's not muted, and then it goes to shit again. You know what I'm saying?
And then you unmute it. That's how that works.
I'm trying to focus on content, Robin.
I know.
I'm trying to focus on a full show. Damn it.
So anyway, we were out. We were dehydrated.
Yes, I definitely was.
Schwitzing out on the lot.
At least I lost some weight.
Me too. But it's only water weight, so that's not good. And we decided drinking was probably not the best idea when you're dehydrated.
Exactly. Especially you did not drink anything on St. Patrick's weekend, Friday, Saturday, or Sunday. Could be a new Guinness Book of World Records. I can't imagine, unless you're obviously an alcoholic and you're not drinking and you're doing a good job.
Yes.
And by choice, staying away from alcohol. I don't need alcohol. That's the thing. I don't like say, I need a drink. That's not one of the cop-outs. That's like when people say, I need a cigarette right now. Nobody needs a cigarette. Nobody needs a drink. And I smoked and I drink, but I'm not, you know, luckily I'm not an alcoholic. And if I were going to be an alcoholic, I would have been a long time ago. So I don't have that desire to drink alcohol or need to drink alcohol. I'm just what you would call a...
social drinker.
Social, conversational, depending on the situation, drinker. And if there's a lot to drink and I drink a lot, then I know when I've drank enough or too much. I always know when Robin drinks too much because you could hear it. And Robin has that, instead of having the turkey thermometer that pops up in a little red thing.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't need that to know when Robin's feeling. And there's nothing wrong with having a little buzz.
No.
But when Robin gets.
I might get a little buzz. I slur just a little
bit. Yeah, but you know, doing that while you're doing a radio broadcast, Robin. You know what I'm saying? Uh-huh. Now people say after sex. That's not. People say, I need a cigarette after sex.
Yeah, that's bullshit,
no,
too.
No, you don't.
If you're a cigarette smoker, you'll use any excuse to actually want another cigarette. So that's bullshit. But
Wayne Atkins is totally legit. My wife said yesterday, I'm sick and tired of being sober. Bring me a drink. Now, come on, man. Anyway, how about Scotty Scheffler yesterday? Now, I wasn't watching a lot of sports over the weekend. I'll be the first. Because, let's be honest. I mean, we were so excited. And I didn't have to watch all these games. That's the thing about college basketball. You know, come Monday morning, you know, there's going to be 1,000 different teams to talk about and who got shafted and who's the bracket. This is all that mattered, you know, because I'm not going to learn anything from watching, you know, WAC games or Mountain West or any of that other stuff because nobody knows the names of these players. And again, I'm not disrespecting the teams or the coaches who worked hard to get there. But yesterday we had stuff to do. So I knew that come Sunday night when I came home, I'll be able to look and see, you know, who got in, who got out. you know, who made the NCAA tournament, which regions, who the seeds, the West is loaded. That's all the stuff you need to know. And then you'll start doing accordingly like everybody else does. Even if you're not gambling, you'll fill out a bracket and you try to win some money. And all these people who say, I'm going to sit there all day, Thursday and all day Friday, watching games from first light till midnight. You're gambling.
Yes.
And I saw my buddy Mike Golic today on his podcast his son.
Yep.
And he's right. You know what this week is? It's a week for men to go and say, I'm going to get a vasectomy, honey.
This
they go to their wife. You already have a couple kids.
The highest rate of vasectomies
exactly.
this weekend because men plan so that they get the vasectomy and mm-hmm. then they are on bed rest for the rest of the weekend and they can sit in front of the TV
exactly.
and watch all the games.
And then when their wives get pissed off at them, hey, I got snip-sip down here. You want me to get up? My balls hurt.
Yeah, feel sorry for me,
biatch. You know, I know you have the
bring
pain.
Bring me a sandwich.
I know you have the menstrual cramps, and I know you had the pain of delivering the baby, which is, among the greatest pains ever next to. I think kidney stones and birth and the birth process have been described by many. I've never given birth, although I looked a little pregnant a couple of weeks ago, but I am not a pregnant man. And birth and kidney stones have both been equated as very similar pains. The excruciating pain of having a kidney stone that's coming out or having a child. I know what kidney stones feel like. I don't know what having a child, but I know what being there when your wife is having a child feels mm-hmm. like and seeing what they go through. So I feel your pain, except if you're in the house of pain. And you know what happens when you're in the house of pain, Robin? What do you do? What do you do? Yeah. It's insane in the membrane, but that's not jump around. Jump up to get down. The show can't really start until Tony yells at Robin.
I wouldn't mind testing that theory.
But you can tell, I'm not yelling at Robin. No. It's not really yelling. Am I throwing anything? Am I going berserk?
You know what? Yelling and throwing stuff do not necessarily go hand in hand.
No, but when you're really, really, really over the top and you need to have some sort of psychiatric evaluation, just yelling or joking around. I joke around most of the time.
Yes,
I jump around too. And I jump up to get down.
People have claimed that you need some psychiatric evaluation.
I'm on medication. I've been evaluated. Meanwhile, are you all right now, Robin?
I'm totally fine. I'm just frustrated that I can't find the video that you wanted me to find.
That's all right. I got to save every video. And when I'm going through all the videos and stuff, we got to do this Florida update, too.
Okay.
We'll get back more to
we'll
the NCAA tournament.
We'll do that as soon as we come back from this
Mickey
commercial
Delaney, break. Be nice to sweet, beautiful Robin, damn it.
Thank you,
I am
Mickey.
Nice.
Thank you, Mickey. I appreciate it. The more people that stick up for me, the better.
Exactly.
Give him shit. Just pile on Tony.
Timothy
I'm
Philip
okay
McDevitt Jr. says, Senior, good thing Deadspin is dead. Can you go back down one, Robin, because the scroll is rolling because people.
Good thing
Deadspin is dead. If not, they would be saying you and your callers are ripping on people in recovery. You're right. That's what they. No, they don't care about that. They want to make everything about race. Deadspin didn't care about talking about alcohol, drugs, tobacco, because they're all drug addicts that work at these companies anyway. These people who work there have to be on drugs to come up with the shit they came up with. So, no, they would not be going after me. In fact, Robin and I, late Saturday night, watched Ricky Gervais, his latest Netflix special.
Oh, my God, he's freaking phenomenal.
And what I love about Ricky Gervais is that he sets up. Now, he's gotten to the point where he sets up the joke
yes.
he's going to say, knowing that people
are
will
gonna be
take
triggered.
It out of context and go after him again.
Yep.
So right now, when you talk about comics,
if you haven't seen his latest Armageddon, you
yes.
got to watch it. It's fantastic.
It's a little gruesome at times.
Yeah.
I mean, he says shit that nobody. I mean, the great comics all do this. What I love about Ricky Gervais, now that he knows that they'll come after him for saying something, oh my God, how did you say that about these people and that people? Now he's got it figured out. He's calling himself woke, so that when he does a joke,
yes.
he can pretend that
Speaking
he's woke.
Speaking of which, we have a woke update when we come back.
We have a woke update?
Yes, we do.
Yes, we do. And by the way, if you're woke, you're not going to like this, but you need to listen to it. And it's not our determination what woke is.
It's science.
Because the bottom line is this, Robin.
Everything woke turns. burns to shit.
We all know that. He's not the only guy who said that. Everybody's saying that now. We're coming right back. Another hour, more good stuff, your phone calls. I want to hear from you about the tournament. Who got jobbed? Would you play in the NIT if you got shafted from the NCAA tournament? Are you going to bet on every game? Do you like the NIT? Who do you like in the NBA tonight? We got a lot of stuff to talk about, so stick around. Tony Bruno, Miss Robin, it's Monday, baby. It's the last day of winter, believe it or not. The last day officially. We're coming right back. Stick around.
It was meant to be. Tony Bruno on the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
Morning, buddy.
Hey, man.
Missed the spot.
Well, well, well. Looks like we got a new neighbor.
Yes, it does.
Can you believe this guy? He's installing cable internet.
Not on our cul-de-sac. Should we go talk to him?
Talk to him.
You're right. Let's go sing to him. Wait a second. Is that who I think it is?
Why the shingle? Why don't you do it in the frame?
Home internet, what a pain in the...
Hey, neighbor!
Try T-Mobile, it sets up so fast.
It's like Wi-Fi that runs on 5G.
Home internet from T-Mobile?
Wait till you see.
Tell me more, tell me more. One cord's all that you need. Tell me more, tell me more.
We're talking serious speed.
You'll be streaming movies and more.
A gaming party behind your front door.
I do love parties.
Stream a class, learn to make cheese.
Well, if you do, I'm a big fan of Brie.
I got you.
It all seems too good to be true when you see what T-Mobile can do. Tell him more, there must be a catch. Tell him more, tell him more.
$50, one wire, no mess.
I can't believe it, it's just $50.
Why pay more?
Paying more sucks. When you switch, it will change your whole life.
Sounds extreme, but maybe he's right.
T-Mobile home internet seems too good to be true.
But that's what T-Mobile can do.
Tell me more, tell me more.
On Paramount Mountain, stakes get higher.
I can't get that thing up there. If it were a football, I'd be able to reach the top.
What about a football-shaped head? We throw the child.
Gutsy call, sir.
Smart thinking.
What? That's dumb thinking. He's not throwing Arnold.
Throw him.
Throw him. Throw him. Throw him.
Hey, do you want an Amelia Idol?
Throw him. What? You can't throw a child at a wall.
Lattimore, shut your face.
Shut my face.
Unless you prefer to freeze to death.
I'm not gonna throw a kid.
Not built for the moment, I see. Fine. I'll throw.
And Creed's here.
Watch and learn.
Dang, he's cool.
It's the fifth quarter, and we need a hole-in-one before the seventh inning stretch. Be brave. Pep, hike!
Can you take me higher? To the place where lying might see.
I just threw him higher.
Come on!
To a place where we won't freeze.
He just threw me high. I'm good.
So close.
How are we gonna get up there?
Now, if there were only someone made of pigskin.
Bingo.
Oh, dear.
Back to the biggest sports network on the planet, the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
Our house wasn't really in the middle of the block. It was at the end of the block, Robin. Where was your house?
Mine was in the forest.
In the forest? It's our house in the middle. You didn't live on a street, Robin? Come on, man.
I had like a long driveway, and then there was the forest right behind us. So it was not really...
Well, you couldn't see for the forest from the trees anyway, Robin. No. So that's another thing. But
Tony Bruno.
Yes.
Shall we go to... Finland for the woke update.
Yes. Wait a minute. Don't we have people listening in Finland right now?
We do.
And so Finland is where they determine where the woke go to die. I thought Ron DeSantis says Florida is where woke comes to die.
Well, let's go to
where?
The Scandinavian Journal of Psychology.
Oh, my subscription just ran out. Damn it.
Man. Tony, you need to keep subscribing to that.
I know. I'm subscribing to too many things. I gotta start saving some money, Robin. So, well, let's go to our woke update from Scandinavia.
Yes. Psychological researchers in Finland have created an assessment to help measure individuals' commitments to principles of social justice and how they view life and how happy they are.
Okay.
All right. So they in Finland and some other parts of Scandinavia, it was kind of all over there, they interviewed people, both men and women, and they found that there were more women than men that considered themselves left-wing, and they believed in certain things like trans women who compete with women in sports are actually reverse of this. Trans women who compete in women's sports are women. So they are... helping women's rights. They believe that.
Right.
They believe that a white person cannot understand how a black person feels equally well as another black person.
Of course.
If a white person has on average a higher level of income than black people, it is because of racism. These are all the woke narratives, right?
Mm-hmm.
And in Finland and Scandinavia, all of these woke isms are not as prevalent as in the United States. They scored lower, but even though they scored lower, they have found that the people who believe all of this stuff are unhappy. They report lower mental well-being scores. So in other words,
let me repeat this again now. This isn't my. These aren't my words.
No, this is science.
You're hearing more and more people say it every day.
Everything woke turns to shit. Okay.
Absolutely.
If you are liberal leaning and believe in all of these wokeisms,
yes,
there is a higher likelihood of you being depressed.
Well, so I've been depressed, but I'm not anymore because I'm not woke anymore.
Do you change this?
Once I was woke.
So
now I'm just awake.
So. One of the findings that they found is they said the scale would need to be validated in North American samples in order to know how these attitudes manifest there, because United States is the country where most of these attitudes have originated from, which means that that's much higher here, which... their correlation, they're thinking that there's a lot more depressed people here in the United States than there is over where they are.
Attitudes, can we say that?
Attitudes.
Attitudes.
So if you're woke, if you have all of those things that you believe in, maybe you should reconsider and just let some of that go and see if that improves your mindset.
Well, most people realize if they pay attention to politics 24/7, and get obsessed with everything that happens every single day, you're going to be depressed.
Yes.
You know, because most of the time, none of it's good news. It's people bitching back and forth about who sucks more than the other guy or gal. Because they all suck. Let's be honest. So, and you're saying you're seeing, and the thing about me is that I point out that the media is really the biggest problem in this country.
Oh, absolutely.
Not the numbskulls on social media, you know, not people doing talk shows, unless they're paid political partisan hacks who are paid to promote one side or the other, which I've never done and never will. I just give opinions based on what I see and how it affects my life. And the bottom line is, you can see the corruption of the media every single day. And all you have to do is pay attention. You don't have to be woke. You don't have to be dumb. You don't have to be smart. You can see what's going on in the country. And if that's okay with you, then you won't be depressed. If it's not okay with you, then you have a chance to go into depression. If whatever you're rooting for doesn't happen, you'll be depressed because you think what you're rooting for is right, and the other person will think what they're rooting for is right. They may both be right, but they won't allow you to think for yourself so that you can determine what's right for you. And the problem is, what's right for you may not be right for me or anybody else. So my way of looking at it is, I look at what's right for me and my family. I look at prices. I look at gas prices going up and down. Does that mean I'm going to vote differently? No, that means I can see reality. I go into stores. I'm not like Bill Maher and these other people who haven't been into a store in years, and then they're sitting out there telling everybody how great it is, that the average Joe should just shut up and, you know, just not pay attention to anything. Do as I say. So that's the stuff that makes people angry, depressed. They're going to get medication. You know, just have fun. We're on the lot yesterday. We're sweating. We're pulling up grass. I'm getting stung by greenhead flies.
It was so much fun.
That is fun because you're getting something done. You're not sitting at home crying about everything that happens.
Yeah,
Jesus.
Actually, it was kind of fun. I know I'm such a geek. I know I'm abnormal, but I love math. And
math.
Yes, I do. And geometry. And I actually was able to use geometry yesterday because
yes.
We had to find
the missing pins.
The missing pins from the city surveyor that shows our property lines. And you had to originate from one point in the middle of the street and then measure an angle and then measure how many feet. And then I was like, okay, the pin should be right here. And I got them right all four times.
No, but we had to do a lot of investigation, Robin.
Only on one of them, the first one.
Because if anybody's been on, you know, I'm not a... You've seen the surveyors, right? The guys that come up with a tripod with that little device on it.
Yeah.
And then somebody's on the other side. That's how they try to determine, you know, which property is yours and where the boundary lines are. And so when they do that, they put this stake into the ground and it's got a number on it and it's marked and those are the lines. Those are where your property starts and finishes. But when you have a lot that's been there empty for 2 years.
Well, and then, we had a hurricane that covered all sorts of stuff. And then we had more grass growing. And then there were seawalls that were put in.
Exactly.
So it all got covered. And they were no longer, they were
But
they
then
were
when
recessed.
You have the paperwork from the surveyor company, from the landscape surveyor, it shows where the pins are supposed to be. Then it's your job. And we didn't have a metal detector. So we bought a rake and we're trying to rake in the precise area where it was. And then I said, Robin, let's get out the map and look. And so in the middle of our street where our house is going to be, in the middle of our... That's why we played a little... who was that? What was the name of that group? That's
got Madness. Weird,
Madness, that's right. And it's madness to try to find a pin. It's like finding a needle in a haystack. When we finally got that first one right from the middle of the street, 30 feet in, that was the...
And
at yes.
a 90-degree angle.
Yeah, we got it right now. So our property now is marked, and I marked it also.
And the fabulous
I marked
Andy
my spot
with... JT Ventures, Venture Brokers LLC, Trucking and Grading.
Yep.
He went out. They graded our property. We missed it.
I know. We missed it this morning.
I know. But they're going to start.
I was
going
to take the day off just to go out and watch them scrape the ground.
I know.
You know what I'm saying?
You guys have, anybody that's listening, you have no idea how excited we are.
It is exciting.
You guys.
When you're waiting a long time to have a house built, you know, and there's always delays. We're just like anybody else. A lot of people have to go through delays when they're trying to get something done. So the delays are over. We're breaking ground, and life is good. And then it ends. You know what I mean?
Well, hopefully it won't end. It'll end many years after we finally get to move into the house so we can actually enjoy it. but, yeah, so the dirt is supposedly being dropped off tomorrow or the day after. I mean, like,
We may have to do a remote from the dirt lot.
I know. Can
when
we do
When they're dumping
that?
Dirt. We can take a
we'll
portable.
Go live.
Let's take a portable. Let's go live.
We'll go live from there on X when the dirt's coming in.
No, it's not USDA grade select rated dirt. It's just dirt. Dirt is good.
And then they said, this was something else that I did not realize. Andy said that it only will take about a week or so to compact. I thought it was going to have to be out there like a month.
I'm going to be out there jumping tomorrow and help compact it. I'm going to get up like the Italians on grapes.
Free form Aggie says, when's the groundbreaking ceremony? We're going to have to go out there tonight or tomorrow morning early and do an official groundbreaking.
Yeah, we bought a couple of shovels because we left all our tools back in New Jersey in the shed with Kathy and Jerry where we were living in New Jersey on their lot. I said, where are we going to put all this stuff? We didn't have a house. So we went over to Harbor Freight on Saturday.
Yeah.
And man, this stuff is good. And we bought a rake. We bought a pointed shovel. We bought a flat shovel. We bought a baby shovel. We bought all kinds of good shit, man. I am ready to work. I am ready. Robin's got blisters on her hand. We're hammering in the post that holds up the permit box. I mean, this is better than sex, ladies and gentlemen. That's why we weren't drinking. Everybody was drinking, getting drunk, and getting wasted. We were over there high on life. You know what I'm saying?
This is how you know that I don't do a lot of manual labor. I did one session of hammering, and I got a blister already.
You can't be soft, Robin.
I guess I am. My hands are soft.
You can't. You got to have hands. You got to have some.
I don't have calluses. I don't have calluses.
You got to get calluses. You got to spit on that hands. If you bleed, you just let it bleed. It's not going to be a bloodbath. Four stays. What is that one?
Ralph Michaels, get them tomato plants in ASAP. Joey B, I'm wearing work gloves as I type in the chat. What's even worse is I was actually wearing gloves. I was wearing work gloves, and it still happened. That's how soft my hands are.
Because I said to Robin, we have one of those, you see them, these stakes. They're real long metal stakes, and mm-hmm. if you want to put a post in temporarily, mm-hmm. you have to hammer it all the way into the ground level,
yeah.
and then you put the post, which is a 4x4 pressure treated, and then you tap that in with a couple of screws, and then at the top you put this, it's called a permit box. So we got it at Lowe's. We attached it from behind. And then I'm like, look, that's the first step. We put our name on there, the permit numbers. I mean, I started getting very, very hard. I was moist. I was sweating. But I was very, very excited, Robin. That's like mission number one started. You know what I mean?
Let me show you. Hold on. I'm gonna.
Do we have the picture?
I'm going to show the photograph of Tony.
It's like family slides, except we're not on vacation. We're working to build the house so that you can
Here
all come down.
Here is Tony standing next to the permit box.
And you see that stake in there. And so Robin, I said, Robin, what, you want to pound on this a little bit? Pound it.
Taking turns.
And we didn't even have one of the long sledgehammers. We had a mm-hmm. short one. And she's going like old Jack, you know, Paul Bunyan on the thing. I said, Robin, you don't have to hit it that hard. Just nice tap, 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 and it gets into the ground. You know what I'm saying?
Here, see, this is me going all Paul Bunyan. See,
yeah, let's
look at
see. Look at this.
Well,
that's animalistic there, Robin. Pounding it like you hate it. Pound that baby.
I needed to get some aggression out. So.
Yeah, then you had blisters.
Well, you know.
You got to work smart, not hard. Yeah. Joe Torre was at the Yankees game today, I'm hearing, too. Well, you know, Joe's still involved with baseball. He's one of the muckety-mucks. And obviously, the Phillies were playing the Yankees. So there's a split squad game today. Phillies at home in Clearwater. So they split the squads up. This way they get down to the final cuts and determine who's going to be in the minors and who's going to break Florida, leave Florida with the team. So that's what's going on. That's why there's two games going on today. Phillies against the Yankees at Tampa. And then the Phillies are playing the Pittsburgh Pirates in Clearwater, but I'm sure most of their starters are not playing in Clearwater today. They're probably playing the Yankees in Tampa. Robin went to Pound Town. Yes, she did. You just tap it, tap it, tap it, tap it, tap it. Timothy Philip McDavid Sr. says, I'm walking on the beach in Fort Lauderdale. Life is great. Just watch out for those spring breakers, man. They will mess you up.
And thank goodness we do not have the same issue that is going on in Texas right now. Did you read about that, Tony Bruno?
Yes.
The Blue Dragons?
Yes. They're not a new college football team down there down in Texas. You won't see them on Friday Night Lights. You won't see them in any bowl games. You won't see them in the NCAA tournament. You will see them on the beach. Let's go to your Texas update, ladies and gentlemen. What the hell are those things on my damn beach in Padre? This is North Padre, not South Padre, not Padre Pio. Let's go to your correspondent, ladies and gentlemen, a woman who's seen many evil creatures on the beach in her days, Miss Robin Austin.
So in Texas, there has been a wash up of all these things called blue dragons.
Blue dragon.
Which look kind of adorable. Let me show this.
They don't look adorable no matter how you look at them.
No,
it,
they look kind of like a little, I don't know, like a little rubber creature that some of your child might get. To bring home, you know, and it, like, and you throw it up against the wall, and then it walks down. You know, they have the suction cups. It kind of looks like one of those things, but ladies and gentlemen, do not touch these suckers. Do not let your kids touch them. If they see something blue and iridescent and shiny, that
it's
looks
not
like
a diamond. It's not a beach pearl.
No, these are highly venomous. They are more venomous.
Only if you
than
touch them. They're not going to come up and
jump
on your face like the alien.
Like
remember the alien?
Yeah, no. These are only if you pick them up. They have stingers on them, and they are more poisonous than the Portuguese man o' war jellyfish. So if you see something blue and shiny and gelatinous, do not touch. Do not touch. Do not touch. And they don't know why they are washing up on the Texas shores right now. But if you are in Texas, Achtung.
Well, this is South Padre Island is a big spring break place.
It is.
But this is it's weird when you see. Did you show the overhead? I don't know if you showed the overhead video of what it looked like. I mean, the whole beach is strewn with them.
Yeah, well, let me. This is a close up of it. So
yeah, that's what it looks like. That's scary. Basically, they're like if you have a gigantic snail or something that's in a shell, or it's more like a Portuguese man of war, except it's not in a gelatinous state. It looks like it crawls on the beach.
Yeah, and then when you
and
see
it's not
it
in a shell.
When you see it on the beach, this is what it looks like because they're dying, and so even when they're dead, they're still poisonous. And they kind roll up on each other. Do not pick it up.
They're not good at eating either.
No.
They're not good eating.
So.
There's your update from South Padre Island.
Yeah.
Has nothing to do with the Dallas Cowboys not being able to sign any star players. I don't believe these are all the Cowboy fans resurfacing after Dak Prescott had to have a $5 million cut on his pay, but he took a check for $5 million so they can come under the cap a little bit more.
And the blue dragons are only about an inch long.
That's it?
Yeah, they're
that
only
thing
about
looked
an
massive.
Inch long. Yeah, I know. They're only about an inch long, but one blue dragon sting has enough power to send a human to the hospital with one single sting.
Bam! And you think those green head flies were all over me yesterday. The one thing about the green head flies down here, unlike the ones at the Jersey Shore and many shore communities, there's these green head flies. They look like regular flies, but they're green and they're big. When they get on you, they don't get off.
Yeah.
They will absolutely go in and bam. These flies, they stay on you, but they're too stupid to move. So as soon as I got one on me, I go bam and I kill it. But those green hides, the green flies, the green heads in another lot of places near shores.
When they bite, they hurt a lot. These were just a
no, they hurt hard. If they get in you. And then you kill them and then they're dead. And then you just get out a machine gun and you just finish them off in the ground. I mean, it's a couple shells, but it's worth it, Robin. You know what I mean? Whatever it takes.
Daniel Motz, that's not the worst thing you can catch at South Padre. Especially right now during spring break.
Exactly. And Harry May said, if you get one of those things on you, the first thing you yell is,
get out! Get out!
Exactly.
Now, Freeform Aggie update on Miami Beach with spring breakers said that things are pretty quiet with the midnight curfew. That's awesome.
Yeah, they have a midnight curfew. And listen, if you need to be on the beach after midnight, then you're desperate, lonely, and you can't score. So get a hotel room, rent somebody, bring them in. By the way, I have an outrage in San Francisco, Robin, too.
Really quick, though, Wayne Atkinson said that the blue dragons and a great white shark named Lee Beth, 14 foot long, have the coast on lockdown.
Down there. That's North Padre. That's not South Padre Island.
I don't know.
I'm sure they're right next to each other. Anyway, there's your creature feature doubleheader for the day. Be careful near the water. Obviously, people here in Florida in the beach already. People are swimming in the ocean. Mm-hmm. Where were we where they were way out there? And I'm saying, man, that's pretty now. It was pretty wild out there. When Jack and Ruth were here.
We just went down to the yacht club down here, and it was the Coosahatchee River.
Yeah, the Coosahatchee River has a fake sand beach there because it's a river, and most rivers don't have beaches. But that place is packed. Because that's the only beach in actual Cape mm-hmm. Coral. Then you go to Fort Myers and you have the real, you know, you have the real Gulf of Mexico beaches. So be careful out there. The water's warming up here. People are getting, you know, they're getting out of their houses now on weekends. I got to see the grandkids on video doing, you know, having fun outside.
It was awesome.
My grandson's had the hose turned on. My son turned on the water sprinkler in the backyard.
It turned 70.
And these two kids, and it's only 75 degrees, and they're running through there, and they're having a good time,
man.
It was
funny because the little two-year-old, they're in their undies. It's 75 degrees out, beautiful sunny day, but the water sprinkler is freaking cold.
Yeah, and you turn on it, especially when it's well water, and it's coming up, and it's like 50 degrees.
And he goes running through it once, and he, like, this startled look on his face, he goes, "Mommy, the water's cold."
And it's deep, too.
No
kidding.
Oh, no,
that's what you say when you go to a bridge and you fish off a bridge. You know what I mean?
Anyway
is right. Now we got more creepy critters. Oh, it's a bunch of snails all together, so they look like a long snake. Be careful
worms.
On the beaches, worms. Anyway, let's get it back to what we were talking about, Robin. Let's talk about baseball.
Baseball.
Dodgers and Padres. They're already in Korea. And I'll tell you what, man, they're having a lot of fun. They got girls dancing on top of the dugouts. Have you seen some of the footage from over there?
Mm-mm.
And it's obviously they're having a good time. You got, you know, Otani's over there. There was another guy, another player from Korea, who was drafted high in the KBO draft. That's the Korean Baseball League, or KBL.
Mm-hmm.
And he's out there striking out Dodgers. And these are, you know, these are major league players and pretty damn good hitters. So watch out. Remember when there was the pandemic and baseball stopped here?
Mm-hmm.
They were playing baseball in Korea, the KBO, the Korean Baseball League, or KBL. And those guys are good. And you're seeing more and more Korean players having an impact in Major League Baseball. Speaking of impact, did you see what they're doing in the Dominican Republic, which has nothing to do with baseball? They're building a wall in the Dominican Republic, and they have, to keep out Haitians.
Wow.
Now, isn't that racist? How dare the Dominicans build a wall to keep out Haitians? What is going on out there? Meanwhile, so the Dodgers, they're going to play on Wednesday and Thursday in Korea against each other. They're already playing exhibition games, and they're having a lot of fun with the folks over there in Seoul. And I've never been to Seoul, Korea, but it looks like a great place. Obviously, they're the good guys down there. But the bottom line is, I like this. I like that the baseball is starting on Wednesday. And then, of course, the regular rest of the team start on the 28th, a week from Thursday, which is Holy Thursday, because Easter's coming up, Robin. Easter. Oh, you see, Bed Bath & Beyond has now changed their sign. Did you see that? Somebody wrote Blood Bath & Beyond and put it up on the top. So Blood Bath, again, no matter how much you don't want to hear about it, it's still up there. It's still out there. Robin almost had a bloodbath on the lot, but we had the medical supplies, so her blister only just started to form a massive mucus-filled thing.
Tony, did you
and
have
I was
to
gonna,
go
I was
there?
Going to get a pin and stick it in there and see if it all exploded.
It had burst already.
But I got to give love to Scotty. I don't know if you saw the end of it. I wasn't watching it live, but I wanted to catch it, and I just missed it. Scotty Scheffler. This guy is like missed when these tournaments start counting. And again, I'm not saying the weekly tour stops don't count, but Scotty Scheffler is without a doubt the best golfer on earth right now. Because when he comes out and wins back-to-back players championships, and he almost had to go to an actual playoff. And the guy shot a 64 yesterday. The guy absolutely positively is beyond human comprehension. Some of the shots he was hitting yesterday, when you shoot 64 and then make the putts and getting out of the bunker, I mean, every single shot had to be right on to shoot a 64. And then the other guy, Wyndham Clark,
uh-huh.
Did you see the last putt? We got to find that, Robin. I thought I saved it. Wyndham Clark had a chance to putt to tie, forcing overtime. And this putt went in and out. I don't know if you, I didn't kiss it, no. Fort Lauderdale, crowded but calm.
Makes big bogey save, that must be it.
No, it's Wyndham Clark
Wyndham
with his
Clark.
Final putt. Everybody thought he had made it, and it came right back out.
Wyndham Clark makes
just
big
when you thought it was
after
in.
Shocking tee shot on number 17.
It sucked you right back out. Just play it, Rob.
All right.
Just play.
I hope this is it. Hold on. I'm trying to get it up to the top of the screen.
Exactly.
Oh, these stupid commercials. Go away.
Robin. I got to find the other one. Somebody posted, the PGA posted the all the shots from Scottie Scheffler in his 64. And he was amazing. PGA, got to go to PGA.
Oh, very short. Very short. He was all the way over on the left side of the tee box. Nothing even close to anything like that was expected. Well short. Tell me, good sound. That sounded terrible. Oh, he hit 2 or 3 inches behind it. 20 yards short.
John Wood.
That shot for way longer than any shot he hit today. Backed off it once, and then he was almost like he was frozen over it.
He's showing one of his bad shots. He didn't have many of those. Is that Wyndham Clark or is that Scottie Scheffler?
You know it. You know, Mike, he doesn't use a tee on the par threes. He didn't use one there with a short iron. I don't get it.
That's not Scott. That's Wyndham Clark. Yes. That's Wyndham Clark.
We have to watch the other one first.
And this is the 17th, of course.
It's much better than what he wanted the first time. That is so impressive. Yeah.
That's not the shot I want. I have to find it, Robin.
Down there. And a chance to...
And Mike Tirico doing the call there of the...
Clark.
So here it is. I got it. Let me play this, Robin. This is Scottie Scheffler. Every shot from his win.
Make it big. Make it big.
Okay, I am. I gotta start it over again.
Yeah.
Here we go.
Here
we go. Yeah, I would look for something just right of the hole location.
First round, he was even. He was got seven
the
shots back.
Very well. Yeah, like that. Oh, that's got to be careful. False front there. It's going to work its way back toward the front.
Remember, he's even first round.
Just not used to seeing that around
McElroy
here,
McElroy and Schauffele were 7 under.
Earlier with the more than 2 inches of rain over the weekend.
Right off the front of the green there.
And steeply uphill up that false front, so control.
Lays it up there. Really nice.
Critical. And
I don't want to have a whole hour here, Robin. There was one that was like condensed into like
in his
a minute.
The short putts.
And then he was struggling in the first round, Robin. And when you watch that and you're saying, damn, he's 7 under in the first round. What is going on out there? But then he caught fire the rest of the weekend. And he was actually 1 back. So he was +1 in the first round. He was 8 shots behind in the first round.
For Scheffler, as we've seen.
Now, let me move ahead, Rob.
Oh, hold on a second. I think I found it. I finally found the actual clip.
Yeah, there's one cut that just shows all of those major shots.
Well, this is the 17th birdie putt to force a playoff. The ball was halfway down into the holes. It rolled back out. Congrats to Scottie Scheffler for winning. So this is
They got to the extra hole because what's his name? Wyndham Clark played great, but Scottie Scheffler was on fire. And then this is what happened at the end.
Closing in on Scheffler till the very last fraction. Look, he was ready to get a fist bump.
That ball went in, all the way in. Look, and then it came out.
Oh.
That's a rare look out that
ball. Oh, man.
And that's how Wyndham Clark came up that much short, and Scottie Scheffler won the tournament because Scottie Scheffler is the greatest golfer on earth. But Wyndham Clark's been good. He's been playing well.
Wow.
Amazing.
That is amazing.
I need to get this. I mean, my clubs are now out of storage in the back of the garage. Jack in the back got to play with him. One of these days, Robin, one of these days, I want to be able to go out and spank Whitey again. You can say that if you're white, because the golf balls are white. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
He was ready to fist pump. That ball was in the hole, Dean. How dare you? Yeah, D. Conrad Vegas. My 53-1 Clark ticket, in and out, dang. Yeah, if you had him to win, that was a win, and that was a nice payoff. Don't be ripping Wyndham Clark, Dean. Uh-oh. Matt Raposo has been summoned early. He's got to go to work. Have a great day, pal, out there on the West Coast. The great Matt Raposo in Livermore, California. You know what I'm saying? But anyway, so that's the golf story for the weekend. I mentioned the baseball. But tonight in the NBA, we've got NBA action. And you know who's going to join us on the show today? Speaking of basketball, college basketball. A man who is locked in to what is all and great about FAU.
Yes.
Florida Atlantic University. Remember last year they made the run to the Final Four? We got a student who is there, is not only just a student at FAU, he's also a broadcaster, part of the Bleacher Brothers Network. He's going to join us because FAU, guess who they played yesterday, Robin? They played my Temple University Basketball Owls. So we'll get a recap. FAU is in the tournament. Temple is not, despite Temple making that great run late. But we'll talk about FAU. Can they make another run in the NCAA tournament as the field has been set? We got NBA tonight. The Heat at the 76ers. I don't know if you saw this earlier, but the Heat last night were playing Detroit. You want to talk about a cursed franchise. The Detroit Pistons have to be the most cursed franchise since I don't remember another team having this kind of luck. They had a chance to win the game last night against the Miami Heat. And then they had the ball. And then they did not call timeout. Cunningham goes up, works the clock down, and then throws up a shot, a three that could have won. But guess what? It didn't go in. No timeouts. Miami gets the ball, comes down, and then a long distance three. Boom! Right in the hole. And the Miami Heat, Bam Adebayo, is the one who went boom. And the Miami Heat beat the Detroit Pistons. And now those Heat come into Philadelphia tonight to play the 76ers. And suddenly the 76ers are favored by 1.5. Now the Sixers, you know, they got a win against a horrible team the other night. No Joel Embiid. He's missed 21 games. And their best player, Tyrese Maxey, has a bloody nose. Now he's supposed to play tonight. But I'll tell you a team that's really in trouble right now is the Cleveland Cavaliers. If you want to jump on a team to bet on tonight, it's the Indiana Pacers. The Cleveland Cavaliers are fading now, and they've got a lot of guys hurt. You know, they got Evan Mobley, Max Strus, Donovan Mitchell's hurt. He's not going to play tonight. And the Clippers, by the way, are fading, and I'll get to them in a second. Cavaliers at Pacers. Pacers are 6.5-point favorites. How depleted are the Cleveland Cavaliers? They just signed Marcus Morris to a 10-day contract because they don't have enough bodies to play the game. So that's an interesting one tonight. I don't know about laying the 6.5, but Indiana's a good team at home. Cleveland's been playing well, but they are really, really banged up right now. So that's an update. Knicks at Golden State tonight, a 10 o'clock game on ESPN. That Heat-Sixers game is the 7:30 game on ESPN on their doubleheader on Monday night. Detroit's at Boston, and the Pistons, coming off that heartbreaking loss, now go up to Boston and are basically 16-point underdogs. And I know my buddy Pete Sheppard and all the Boston fans know how good the Boston Celtics are, anybody who watches them. But every time I see the Celtics laying like 16 points, I always wonder. I always wonder.
Tony, I have breaking news.
Is this good or bad?
Oh, my God. This is amazing.
Now time.
We just got a text message from...
Mark Teixeira?
No, from somebody named Jimmy Donaldson, better known as Mr. Beast. You know...
Mr. Beast texted us?
Yes.
Are you serious?
Yeah. Let me read you the following text.
All right. I've never met Mr. Beast, but he's a beast from what I hear.
Oh, man. We need to jump on this right away. Hello. My name is Jimmy Donaldson, better known as Mr. Beast. I'm an American YouTuber born in Wichita, Kansas, United States. You can check my page on YouTube, Mr. Beast, and Instagram at Mr. Beast. I give charity to people, so I'm giving out money to people because I can't reach out to everyone.
Good. I need money. I'm building a house, Mr. Beast. Help a brother out. Help a poor white bro out in his final years as a retired guy in Southwest Florida.
So, if you get this text on your phone, then you have been chosen to be a lucky winner.
Oh,
text great. My manager, Reed Duchster, with a phone number and send this code to him. And then it's something this long.
All right, you got
to
do it,
Robin.
He
will be glad to help you because we want to make the world a better place before
we die. Well, it's about
that.
Because forget about all those. What's the one we get every day? And they never give out the prize. Publishers Clearinghouse. Yes. You at time it could he be coming? Could the what is that? The prize
patrol car.
Could it be coming to your home today?
This
isn't published. This guy's like, legit, Robin.
Oh, he's totally. It's so legit. It's kind of like my my long lost prince from Nigeria.
No, Mr. Beast is legit. He is.
Yeah.
The Nigerian princes are all bullshit.
Oh, this has to be
Publishers Clearinghouse is a scam. They just want you to buy crappy magazines, yes. And nobody buys newspapers or magazines anymore. You know what I'm saying? But Mr. Beast, haven't you seen the videos of him with Tom Brady on the boat? Remember when he threw the pass? Tom Brady was throwing the pass. This guy's a real...
He's a real guy. But clearly this is not real.
How do you know? How do you know, Robin? This could be the break we need. Not to get rich, to build the damn house. We're going to be short to build a house. I'm not looking for $1 million. And I'm not going to go door to door. But we need help. And Mr. Beast may
be
the answer.
Timothy Phillips says, call J.G. Wentworth if you need cash now.
But I do not have a structured settlement. And I need cash now.
Yeah.
So if I have a structured settlement and I need cash now, I would call J.G. Wentworth, 877-CASH-NOW. But I don't have a structured settlement. I don't have a structured anything. I don't have structure, except the show and maybe Robin every once in a while. And we're going to have a structure by the end of the week because we're going to have dirt on our lot.
Well,
so is that
Free for Maggie says the Powerball tonight is $645 million. We need to go down and play.
I have the ticket in a car, and then we never check it. We play once we're in a soup. When I'm in a supermarket and we're buying milk, I see the lottery machine. I said, you know?
Oh, no, Robbie.
What?
He said, I'm so sorry. I had an emergency come up when I got to my parents' house. I'm not going to be able to make a fight. So hopefully everything's okay there.
So Robbie Listella, even though his FAU...
Yeah, well, he just got back on a flight. He called me or texted me immediately after he landed and said, yes, I definitely want to do it. And then, sorry for the delay, I just got off the plane. And then he just texted me saying he has an emergency.
I hope everything's all right. That's all that matters.
Okay. Yes,
I mean, screw FSU. I mean, FAU, FCS, and all the other FDS. Don't forget FDS.
Let me read a couple more text messages.
Let's get to the text, Robin.
We are getting messages, just so that you know, whoever's listening. We have text messages coming in on the 352 number, and then we have tons of messages that are coming through on all of our social media that we are seeing. But that I see on a running thread. But the text messages I have to open up and read. So this is from area code 570. If you are texting, please remember to sign your text with your name and where you're texting from.
And your social security number and your credit card information.
Otherwise, I have no idea who it is. It says, damn, for a second, when you guys read the number, I thought it was my weed dealer getting a new cell phone. That's what it reminds me of, you guys. I've had two different numbers over the years.
570, that's Pennsylvania. That's up there in Joe Biden territory up there in Scranton. Wilkes-Barre,
570.
Williamport.
It's Blind Mike. Blind
Mike.
Oh,
the great Brian. He's up there in the Scranton area.
Yeah, he texted back again. So that 570 number is Blind Mike. Yo, what up? It's Blind Mike checking in with the amount of times you've had your number changed over the last whatever couple of years. We have my weed man. Anyway, it's about maybe he's already had some.
By the way, I have breaking news from the criminal activity department. Shangela. You remember Shangela? You probably don't remember the name. Drag queen Shangela. Remember the woman who went to the White House for Pride Month and she pulled off, she had her top off?
Yes.
So drag queen Shangela, who was invited by Kamala Harris to the White House, was just accused of multiple sexual assaults. I'm reading this from Rolling Stone magazine. So it's no far right site because, you know, Rolling Stone gathers no moss. And it normally doesn't produce shows. So from former RuPaul Drag Race star Darius Pierce, that was the original name, of a previously unreported police report, adamantly denies ever in non-consensual sex with anyone. So Darius Pierce is Shangela, a breakthrough star, and she rose to one of RuPaul Drag Race's most beloved contestants, and then she went to the White House when she was invited there, where they had the big event on the lawn. She was on Andy Cohen's show. And now, apparently, she is facing charges. Facing a wave of conservative and anti-drag and anti-LGBTQ laws across the U.S., Followers have flocked to Shad Gallo for motivation in a dark time for the queer community. I'm reading this from Rolling Stone. "I'll forever cherish this moment," Shad Gallo wrote to her $1.6 million Instagram followers following her SAG Award red carpet appearance. But now apparently, four people allege to Rolling Stone that Darius Jeremy, DJ Pierce, the man behind the famous drag persona, either sexually assaulted them or attempted to have sex with them when they were too inebriated to consent. A fifth person claims that Pierce attempted anal penetration in a bathroom despite rejecting. So these are allegations now, and he's 43 years old, and now all of a sudden he's facing some issues with the law. I don't celebrate this. I don't care. I mean, you know, this is what happens. You know, when you just you praise people and you don't know what's going on. I was never against her. And what she did at the White House was ridiculous. You know, you can't do that. There's got to be decorum. You know, it's like when you go to an event and you're not dressed up. When you're a guy and you got a hot, beautiful woman in Vegas and she's all dolled up and you're wearing flip-flops, a tank top, and shorts.
Or like the photograph that I saw earlier of a wedding. She's in her wedding dress and it's absolutely gorgeous. And then the dude's wearing jeans and a T-shirt.
Exactly. So there's decorum.
There's decorum.
And if you're going to be invited to the White House lawn, whether you like the president or not, whoever it is, you don't go topless.
No.
So anyway, that's the latest on that. But anyway, we got a lot of stuff to talk about too, Robin. We mentioned the NBA. We mentioned some baseball, some golf, NIT. And people already posting up. Joe Quill says, "I sacrificed a pick today for the unofficial horse of the Bleacher Brothers winning today on the ninth at Parks." What do you mean you sacrificed a pick today?
Apparently, people were ripping Joe because of his picks because he was real cold. And then Dean said, "For those wanting to rip Joe for horse picks, the best of best handicappers only win about 20% of bets on the horses." So Joe is actually a very good
absolutely
picker,
and horse. The thing about horse racing, you know, the thing about horse racing during this time of the year, you know, the stakes races are going to start to come up because of the Kentucky Derby. So you'll see all the big stake races around the country, which are basically the ways to get these top horses qualified or give the people a chance to look at who the potential Derby horses this year. We knew who the two-year-olds last year. We knew who's going on now. So we'll see a lot of new names emerge. And right now, you know, there's meets going on around the country. No, Robin was not topless on the boat yesterday. We weren't on the boat yesterday, Steve. We were on the lot. We were on dry land. And even though I whipped it out to pee on the lot because there was nobody around, Robin did not remove any articles of clothing.
No,
in fact,
didn't.
She put all long sleeve and long pants on because she didn't want to get sunburned. And I said, "Robin, put sunscreen on." And she didn't. And guess what?
Look at the
back of your neck, Robin. Dirty
did.
And gritty and burned.
I put sunscreen.
You were not sunburned because you wouldn't listen to me.
All right, Dad.
It's not about Dad. It's about you're white.
Yes,
you're
I am.
You're very white.
I'm very
and
white.
When you go out in this hot summer sun, it's not even summer. The sun is hot here. I look at the UV index. My tan look good today. I look nice and dark and
yes,
lovely.
Yes, you are dark and
because
lovely.
Because I put sunscreen on and then I wear a hat. I don't need to be in the sun for 15 hours. It's bad for you. So I'm about safety. And then Robin defied me and did not even listen when I said, "Put some damn sunscreen
lies,
on."
Lies. I did.
Yes, we have the best. We got to do this too, Robin. Yesterday in the NBA, one of those
yes.
great, great moments. We do have this video.
We do have this video.
It's one of the greatest videos you will ever see. Maybe the greatest jersey swap you will ever see in sports. Now, you see this a lot in the NFL, and soccer players do it a lot too.
Mm-hmm.
I think it started overseas with soccer players, you know, in all those leagues in Europe. And after a game, the two stars would go out all sweaty, and then they'd exchange the jersey like Messi
right.
would give his shirt to another guy on the other team, and they would exchange it. And you see it now with Messi in Miami.
Mm-hmm.
They do the same thing, you know, in the American soccer leagues. But football players do it at the end of games. They exchange it with the quarterbacks exchange.
Yes.
So anyway, yesterday in the NBA, you don't see this very – now, remember, this is a regular season game. This isn't a playoff game.
No.
This isn't the last game of a series.
But
you know
these
what I'm
two gentlemen, they saw an opportunity.
Yes. One of them was a rookie from the Orlando Magic.
Mm-hmm.
The other one was a rookie from what team was he on, Robin? I got it written down here. I wrote it down, Robin. Do you have the video
pulled up? I have the video.
It says it on the sheet where I put the video.
Oh, sorry.
One guy's last name was Dick.
You said two rookies, two shirts, no cups.
That's right. So I used a line that somebody would have used if I didn't say it before we played it on the air. And so...
Dick was on Kansas.
Yeah, he was a Kansas Jayhawk. And this was in the NBA. Now, these guys are in the NBA now.
Mm-hmm.
So these guys were in the NBA. One's playing for the Orlando Magic, and the other one's playing for, I forget who the team was, because I don't remember, because you have the freaking video. Just play the video, Robin. If I don't write this shit down, I have to go, then have to worry about you putting it up there, damn it. Let's play it.
What?
Yes. When you hold a team under 100 points.
The Raptors.
Toronto Raptors.
Magic shooting over 50% as well.
So the Magic smoked the Raptors.
Number to keep an eye on, 22-1 are the Magic when shooting 50% or better.
Play the kind of defense the Magic do if you're making shots. That's a winning combination.
So then they position themselves correctly.
Okay.
They're like, oh no, turn around, other side.
Then the black guy, whose name is Black, goes on to the left side. And the kid whose last name is Dick from the Magic is wearing his jersey. And then let's put them on, boys. Let's put those babies on.
They just held him up.
No, they had him on. They had him on.
Oh, no, this one, this video cuts it off. But they held it up. So
no, play the video.
It went back to the beginning, Tony Bruno.
Okay,
right there.
So they hold it up. So it says Black Dick. Black Dick. You know what I'm saying? Black.
And everybody's laughing. And they made sure that they got it on camera. That's pretty. Anthony repositioned himself because at first he was on the other side. So it would say Dick Black. And then he's like, whoops, no, hang on a second. Oh, my gosh. That's
Black
so funny.
Dick, baby. And I'll tell you what. I don't know about you. But once you go black, you never go back. You know what I'm saying?
That's not true.
Cut Tony's mic off. I'm pissed off that he yelled at you.
Thank you.
It wasn't BB Dick, BBC. It was Black Dick. Two dicks at the same time.
No, one black, one dick.
But yeah, you're right.
There you have it, folks.
I write it on the sheet, the page where I post the videos so Robin can play them. But then if I don't write them on my thing, then I forget how I led into it. So can you repeat it just because I've spent all that time thinking of a clever line so I could play the bit before we
the
got
the greatest jersey swap in sports history. Two rookies, two shirts, and no cups.
There you have it. I mean, that's a brilliant thought process. You know what I mean?
Do you know what else is a brilliant thought process?
What?
We have open lines.
Let's go. I want some people to call in now.
If you call in right now,
right
I will
now,
be able to answer
Mr. Beast, number. I'll give Mr. Beast your email address, and maybe Mr. Beast will send you some fabulous prizes.
If you call in at 352-234-8669, that's 352-234-8669.
Exactly. So I want to know about tonight's hockey action now. Because, you know, here in Florida, we got a great team in the Florida Panthers. The Tampa Bay Lightning aren't too shabby. The Boston Bruins obviously have 95 points. They already have 40 wins. So there's a lot of good hockey going on right now. I mentioned the earlier retirement announcement today by the great Flyer legend Wayne Simmonds. They're going to have an honorary celebration where on April 13th, the Flyers will honor him at home against the New Jersey Devils. Now, hopefully they don't have bobbleheads. Did we ever find out if they found the bobbleheads for Pittsburgh?
Let me see.
I need an update on that story, Robin. You know what I'm talking about? So anyway, a lot of people are doing stuff on Twitter, which I don't really want to get into because it's all bullshit. It's all, you know what it is, Robin, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, y'all, let's do this.
No, we're not going to do that.
No, they still have not been.
So the bobbleheads are still missing, and the Penguins had that big celebration on Friday night at the arena with Jaromir Jagr.
Nobody has found the bobbleheads.
But they're going to get new ones as soon as they make them in China. and then they shipped them back over.
Now, Tony, speaking of new.
Yes.
Did you see the new Arizona Cardinals?
Yes. I pointed this out to you. It's a great story. Because I sent you a bunch of videos.
Yeah, and I have a video. It's 2.5 minutes. It shows the...
All of my friends out there in the desert. You don't have to comb the desert anymore. When you go see the Arizona Cardinals this year at the beautiful big State Farm Arena. It's called State Farm Stadium now, right? It was a bunch of things before. It was jobbing.com, and they keep changing the name of it. The Super
Bob.
Bowl. No, the Bob was the
That's
baseball
right.
stadium.
This was the
Come on,
one.
Robin. You don't even know your Arizona stadium.
No, no, no. I was just thinking.
Football.
It was jobbing.com, and then it was, what else
it's
was
State
it?
State Farm
Yeah,
right
State
now.
Farm now.
And they had the Super Bowl last year when we were there, and now they're getting ready for a new season. But those seats in the corners, they're not good enough.
It was meant to be. Oh. Tony Bruno.
Why is it
on
taking
the Tony
us off
Bruno here, Sports
Network. Hang on.
Things make no sense.
What the
Marinated
hell's going
in Louisiana
on?
Spices, hand battered and flipped, and then we have the audacity to call all five flavors fast food? Don't you really say something?
Now back to the biggest sports network on the planet, the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
What is going on back there?
That was bizarre.
What is going on back
there? I don't
know.
I mean, that thing just jumped in and cut our asses off.
It did. I mean, we went to our half-hour break, so I'm not sure why that happened. Doesn't matter. We're back on track.
Okay.
So the Arizona
Cardinals State Farm Stadium, it's called now. No, this isn't the Bleacher Brothers show.
No, they're Joe Quills is saying that because that happens to them often, I think.
Yeah, but it's like 9 minutes before the hour.
Yes.
You know, if you get close to the top of the hour, sometimes the machine cuts us off prematurely. And when you cut off your Slauson prematurely, then you're going to have a bloodbath, I would assume, because that's a lot of blood comes out when that gets cut off.
I would think so, yes.
You know what I mean?
But we don't want to go there.
No, we don't. But meanwhile, so let's go to Arizona. So this is what happened. They said, you know, all those people in the end zones – they're sitting there, and of course, you know, they want to watch the game. The quarterback's playing video games, but let's come up with a better idea. Let's make some awesome field-level end zone seats where people with a lot of money, primarily from the Scottsdale area where all the women are, you know, have
can fake pay
boobs.
Even more money to watch the games.
But this is going to cost the women who are perhaps, you know, looking to have more breast enhancements. Or plastic surgery. And not that there's anything wrong with that. If you got the money and you can make yourself look better, you know what I mean? You go and you buy yourself these seats. Let's check it out. This is the red zone at the State Farm Stadium in Arizona out there in the desert in Glendale.
The Casita Garden Club
Yes, you had to be rico to own these seats or to rent them because you ain't taking them home with you. Let's go out to Arizona, Robin, and get an up-close and personal look at the brand-new Casita seating at your Arizona Cardinals. Of course, most people can't identify most of the Arizona Cardinals right now, but it's the newest in luxury, Robin. Here it is. NFL luxury seating experience. Two new private field-level clubs. Six on-field seating experiences. All-inclusive food and beverage. The Casita section. On one side, they'll have
the casitas and then the casita club right behind it.
The garden club, yo. I went to a garden party. And they got like little casitas and then they got some second floor levels on top of the casitas. There'll be mamacitas in the casitas.
I'm sure there will be.
Tacos. There'll be burritos.
So it's like these two-level casitas where, and they're big. I mean, you can.
And the players come out, and then you can, you know, say, hey, who are you? I don't remember you. Kyler Murray will come out with his Game Boy. Is James Conner there? Is he still on the team? Look at those seats, man.
There's field boxes that you can sit in. Well, that looks like a press box.
Yeah.
What's in the box?
You're in the box. Now, I'm hearing the prices of these things
are outrageous.
Oh.
And you know that there's going to be, so there's field boxes and field suites. Damn. So they're just up in, there's the Morgan Athletic Club. They are going high end everywhere.
Because, you know, it's Arizona. They're not going to put a swimming pool in like they have at the Bob where the Diamondbacks play. They got that cool, they have a tunnel suite.
So that, the tunnel suites, I believe.
That's the side where they roll out the field from the parking lot.
Right.
The casita side, there's too much shit to move out of the way. You know what I mean? You know what I'm saying? So anyway, there it is. How much would you pay for that, Robin, if you were a season ticket holder to your Arizona Cardinals?
I would not. So, oh, and then they have like when the players are going through the tunnel.
Yes, they come out and they slap your hands and they get your numbers. Some chicks with gigantic fake boobs come out and say, hey, bro, let's hook up afterwards, man. Let's go up there to my private casita.
I know people
are
going
to. Hey, senorita, come to my casita.
I know people are going to pay up the wazoo for this.
Oh, baby, yes.
To make themselves feel special. But, I mean, it still goes back to, like, you and I have talked about it many, many times. We would still rather be sitting watching a big screen TV.
But not if you're at season. This isn't for Super Bowls. This is for the regular season.
Yeah, so you're going to pay an entire season long that much money, I get? I mean, if you have it, you have
it. Listen, ours is to judge. But we know if the Arizona Cardinals aren't good, they will not come. Because Arizona is one of those towns where if your team's not good, they're not going to show up. They're not like cities like Pittsburgh. Well, Pittsburgh doesn't have a lot of losing seasons. Arizona's been up and down. But Cleveland, those fans, no matter how bad the Cleveland Browns are, they're going to be there. And by the way, they're going to be there in bad weather. Arizona's got the dome. It's a beautiful stadium. They got the fresh field that comes in and out. And so there's really no way. You don't really suffer when you go watch football in Arizona or baseball.
No.
Beautiful stadiums.
Beautiful stadium. But
domes, air conditioning, whatever you need.
Freeform Aggie is correct that the luxury seats are all about comps.
Yes.
So there's going to be big corporations that are buying them. And then they're going to be schmoozing their people.
Some guy's not coming from Taco Bell and said, oh, shit, I should have waited. I could have gotten my casitas and my burritos and my mangoes and anything else I want in here.
You know who's... Oh, actually, I can't say that because we have to go to commercial break for real this time. But you know who's not going to be able to afford these seats?
Me?
No.
You?
Bruno Mars.
That's right. We have a Bruno Mars. I've been saying to Robin, where the hell...
Has Bruno Mars been?
Have we seen him? He was the biggest star in the world a couple years ago.
And he just sort of fell off the face of the earth. We kind of know why.
We have a Bruno Mars update. No relation. What is going on back there with him? Plus, we'll have the latest on the NHL, NBA, and college basketball. We'll talk more about the tournament brackets. Is your bracket set? Do you wait? Do you fill it out right away? Do you need to do more than one? As my boy Mike Golic used to do, they would do the Sheets of Integrity on ESPN in the mornings. Are you playing my favorite song, Robin? One of my favorite songs, West End Girls? Yes. This is West End Girls and the Dead End Walls. And the Eastbound Girls. And
by the Pet Shop Boys.
Love the Pet Shop Boys, man. Crank this up, Robin.
It's a westbound world. And Eastbound Girls.
And the West End Girls.
It was meant to be. Tony Bruno on the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
These make no sense. Marinated in Louisiana spices, hand-battered and flipped, and then we have the audacity to call all five flavors fast food? Someone should really say something or order something.
Love that chicken from Popeye.
I was 36,000 feet in the air when...
Excuse me, is there a doctor on the plane?
I'm a doctor.
The name's Umstick. Dr. Umstick. Get my bag, stat.
Sure!
Sweet, creamy relief.
Am I gonna be okay?
I have no idea. I'm not a body doctor.
What? Where did you all get those?
Can somebody help me?
I'm sorry about it.
Another day, another drumstick.
Ladies and gentlemen, you've been waiting, and now it's here. TBSN, the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
Make some noise!
The Tony Bruno Sports Network. Download the app, tell your friends, the game is on. TBSN.
10, 9, 8, 7.
Music, please.
You
Are you ready? Are we rolling? Can you hear me now?
Yep, ready?
All right, here we go. 3, 2, 1. You know me. I've been around forever.
I know him. I know him.
This is the Tony Bruno Show. Here he is, the godfather of sports radio. Here's Tony Bruno.
Yes, kids, we continue the party here, welcoming all of our folks watching on No Filter Network, our original home for the last few years.
And Caffeine TV.
And Caffeine TV, and everybody else listening and watching all over the world. You're listening on the Tony Bruno Sports Network app. Download it. Boom. You can hear us anywhere on Earth every single day. If you're watching on No Filter, you know you can watch us every single day, Monday through Friday, of course. But then we'll re-air it. Caffeine TV puts it on there so you can watch our beautiful faces, our eyes, ears, nose, and throats.
Yes, and this is the No Filter Hour in our three-hour program that we air exclusively.
But I'm unfiltered every day, every hour of every day,
that
Robin.
That is true. That is true.
Unless you're Fort Myers, Southwest Florida water, you better be filtered. Because we need filtered water, and we have great filtered water thanks to the Palm Beach Water Purification Company. Because as much as I love living here in Southwest Florida, the water here, I'd rather drink water in Tijuana than drink water here.
The water here sucks ass.
It does suck ass.
It sucks ass.
Can you say suck ass on the show?
Yes, I'm saying it officially. It sucks ass. And we would
How does a sucking ass taste? I don't know, Robin.
Well, it tasted like shit. That's what it tasted like.
Okay. But the amazing thing to me is, and I love it here, we go to restaurants, and they always bring water out for you. And then I'm afraid to taste it. So I taste it anyway. I say, maybe they filter their water in this restaurant. And then I taste it and I said, no, I'm not drinking it. I'm sorry. It's just a taste thing. So for all the stuff we talk about, you know, Philly and New York water is really good.
Even though those cities
are bigger and there's dirt and there's trash everywhere and the rivers are filthy, their filtration's better. So we got to get our water situated. That's why everybody has to have filtered water down here. People buy bottled water. We have a filter. We have a filter in our refrigerator.
And if you live in Florida and you would like to also have fabulous water like we have, go to Palm Beach Water. Contact them. They are amazing.
And they're not just spots. They're friends of the show.
Yeah, they are.
They fixed our water. We have double filtration. In our sink, we have one of these 16-inch filters. It goes all the way up. It looks like the biggest dildo you will ever see. And it's silver. And gold.
And it's very effective.
It's really good. And then it goes through our refrigerator and filters that. We got more filtration here than
Tito's vodka.
We're more filtered than Tito's vodka.
That's what I'm saying. We have more filter than
absolutely.
Tito's vodka.
Absolutely. So it's good water. Filter your water down here. And don't forget to spay or neuter your pets. But whatever else you're supposed to do.
To continue, we were saying that Bruno Mars would not be able to afford the new seats at the Arizona Cardinals Stadium
where they're doing the casita seating in the end zones. And it's all about field-level seats. But you know, and we all know, anybody who's been down at field-level seats, there's people standing and you really can't see the game.
Right.
And so I get it. That's more of an experience to sit in those casita seats so you can all your friends can see you and you can say, hey, look, I'm rich. Look at what I'm eating. Look what you're eating out there. I don't think people think that way. But when you're super rich, they think that way.
They're like,
peasant, I'm sitting here. I can't see the game. But you're up in the second level where you can see the game at midfield. But my seats are better than yours. You know what I mean?
I have to admit, when I was sitting in a box watching a baseball game, I remember looking down and going, oh, yeah, I'm really happy not to be one of the peasants down there. Now, I wasn't like overly, but it was really nice being up in a box. I have to say that. And there was a little, it just for a moment crossed my mind that it was much nicer in the box than down there.
What's in the box? Robin?
What's in the box?
You're in the box. I don't need to be in the box. I just need to be in the stadium. Were we in a box at the Phillies game? No. We in a box when we go. We go. We sit in good seats, the best seats we can get. It's two filters at the same time is absolutely
now,
right.
Now, Joey B is saying, hey, Tony and Robin, Lee County, Florida, which is where we live, Cape Coral's part of it, was on patrol live last
That's the show that used to be the Reels. Cop one that Dan Abrams did, remember?
Yeah.
And then they took it off. That was on True TV or something. And now...
Was it a new episode, Joey
B? There's a new show. But, you know, it's on a channel nobody has or can't find. Reels Network, R-E-E-L-Z Dan Abrams, and they still have the original police guys who are on there, and they have cars on patrol, live cameras. So when they do a stop, you know, you're wondering, you know, if some meth head's going to come out and blow your head off.
We have great cops here, though.
Yes, we do.
The cops here are fantastic.
Yes, we do. So I want to know. I got to see that.
And Sheriff's Department. So back to Bruno Mars.
So
Bruno Mars, the reason we were questioning that we hadn't seen him for a while, and apparently he is...
He was in Vegas when we were there for the Super
Right,
Bowl.
Well, he is one of the resident... He has one of the residencies at MGM. Mm-hmm. Well, he can't leave. He is going to be in residency for a little while.
Has he been locked in at the which casino now?
Because he apparently has racked up over $50 million in gambling debt.
What?
$50 million in gambling debt.
He's $50 million in debt to the casino. By the way, he's in debt to the casino where he works, and they pay him, right?
Yes. So he makes about $90 million a year off the deal he did with a casino, but then he has to pay back his debt. So he will only make about $1.5 million per night after taxes.
Oh, he's got to scrape by on one, but he still has to pay them back.
Yes.
So basically, they're taking money out of his salary as he goes into the casinos and keeps losing. And that's what happens to a lot of people. Bruno Mars, I read the story. He said he started gambling when he was 19. He lived in Southern California, and he would go to the local Indian casinos there and bet. So he became addicted to gambling, and luckily he's a big-time star. But now he's got a residency, and I didn't even know he had a residency there because I've been saying we don't see him much anymore. Remember, he was a superstar.
Yeah.
I'm not saying he's not a star anymore, but like we didn't see him anywhere during Super Bowl week. Was he having events? You know what I'm saying? Yeah, I know he's worth $175 million. But when you lose $50 million, I don't care how rich you are, you lose $50 million gambling – and you're losing it to the company that you work for and puts you up, that sort of like defeats the purpose. Now, God bless him. He's got $1.5 million, you know, still every day. But hopefully he stays away from the – because if he gets deeper and deeper in debt, you may be working for them.
Well, here's the problem. Like, they can cut him off, right, at MGM. But then
right.
What if he goes to another property and then accrues debt up there?
Exactly.
Then he's going to be owing everybody everywhere.
See, if I had seen him in Las Vegas, I would have said, gambling problem, call 1-800-GAMBLER. And all would have been forgotten.
Speaking of gambling
problems,
let's go to Luigi Curto.
Oh, the man, he puts a couple shekels. I guarantee you, Luigi has his NCAA men's bracketology all filled out, all including the first four in on Tuesday and Wednesday night in beautiful downtown Dayton, Ohio. Let's go to the man himself, Luigi Curto. What up, yo?
What up, man? I actually haven't even had time to look at the bracket. I've been on the phone with Bruno Mars for the past 2 days trying to borrow $50. This guy's relentless, man.
Bruno Mars. Him, did you know Bruno Mars was $50 million in hock?
That's what I told him. You got to split tens. You got to quit splitting tens, you fucking maniac.
Oh, man.
It's tough times, man. I understand, but, you know. I'm gonna loan it to him. I understand what it's like, so I'm gonna loan it to him.
I'm waiting for Mr. Beast to send me money. We got an email from him today.
Yeah, I heard that, Tony. I heard that thing. I'm actually I got a phone call from Mr. Bad Beast.
Mr. Bad Beast.
He ruined parlays.
Wait, doesn't he work on Sports Center on Monday nights with that Stanford Steve guy?
Yeah, I believe so. I think you can still get him on 94.1 or 6:10 a.m. I think he's still buying radio time.
Wait a minute, Joey B says Luigi, where's his walk-up song, Robin?
This was an unscheduled visit.
Unannounced. Luigi has just burst into the room unannounced.
I have a slate up for him, though, so at least I have that.
Oh, you're on camera, too. You're not just phoning it in, huh?
No,
or mailing it in.
It's a picture.
Oh, you don't... Oh, that's a picture, a still picture of Luigi?
Yeah.
He moves. I mean, he's real.
Use a picture of a horse. It's a more accurate depiction.
By the way, I have breaking news. I just got this today. I saw Jeff Lynn's ELO saying, big announcement today. Now, you know Jeff Lynn is the original ELO front guy. And they're still touring, Luigi. Tickets are going sale Monday. Yeah. Let's see. He's going to start in Palm Desert, California, Seattle, Vancouver, Portland, San Francisco. So he's doing West Coast. Then he's going to St. Louis, Indianapolis, Toronto, Pittsburgh, Cincinnati, Cleveland, Philadelphia on September 20th. We saw him at the Wells Fargo Center.
Best concert we've ever been
Phenomenal.
I love
Phenomenal.
The ELO, man.
ELO is great.
I love ELO.
The guy sounds exactly the same, and his orchestrations are brilliant. And you know who got us those tickets? Our buddy in down in North Carolina.
Yep.
You remember the guy's name?
Who
he was one of our I haven't heard from him in a long time. It was one of our listeners from North Carolina who knew that we liked ELO, and then he bought us concert tickets and sent them to us so we could go see ELO in Philadelphia a couple of years ago, man.
Right. I told him I like ELO, too. He told me to go fuck myself.
Come on, Luis. This is a family show. All right. Now, did you follow any of the bracketology over the weekend? Did you follow any of this? Did you watch all of these championship games over the weekend?
Yeah, I think it's a joke. I think it's a joke. And to be honest with you, it's been kind of talked about here locally, but it is worth mentioning. I mean, my God, tell me, I mean, do you think you'd ever see the day where not one team from Philadelphia is in the tournament?
They're in the NIT. They're in the NIT, baby. No, there was a chance that none of them. I mean, Villanova had a good run. St. Joe's to me was the most impressive. Temple did well too. They even beat. You know, FAU. FAU was a team that was in the Final Four last year. So give Temple credit because they were horrible. They weren't even shaving points, and they started winning games.
That's what I said. If they weren't throwing games, it'd have been all right.
But say, by the way, Phil Martelli.
Women, though.
Phil Martelli is going to join us tomorrow. The former St. Joe coach. Phil's coming on tomorrow. We'll talk college hoops with him.
Nice.
Because the NIT is this week also, and St. Joe's is in the NIT. Villanova's the Hawk will never die,
Hawk
as you know.
The Hawk may never die.
Exactly
the
right,
Hawk
man.
The Hawk may never die. They can become completely irrelevant like it has.
Villanova's at home against VCU, and that's the thing about the NIT. Teams play home games. So we got Villanova home against VCU on Wednesday. St. Joe's will be playing against Seton Hall, and Seton Hall was a team that was robbed from the NCAA tournament. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I think
they were robbed.
The way I look at the tournament, I haven't really paid super attention to it like I would have in years past. But just looking at it this year, I mean, it's far and away UConn is the best team in the country.
Houston's pretty damn good, too.
They are good, but the way I look at it is this is UConn's tournament to lose.
Absolutely.
I think if somebody else wins, it's just because UConn didn't beat them. It's because UConn just didn't show up for some reason. Because they should be able to just roll the ball out and win this game.
No, it's not that easy. Look what happened to Kansas. I mean, Kansas was playing well, and then they couldn't beat anybody down the stretch. Houston had a couple of blips, but then when they come out on the floor, to me, man for man, as much as I love what happened to Connecticut, and I know a lot of those guys and the coaching staff up there. I mean, Houston now. Houston hasn't been this good since back in the Slamma days. Remember those days?
Yeah. No. Well, they were actually good a couple years back too, and they also fell on their face. UConn, like you just said right now, you know some of the guys on the coaching staff there, and they're all a bunch of great kids. But they are well coached. They are
probably
the best coached team in the nation. So that's what I look at. You look at the talent all around. I don't know. I just can't see them losing. That's just me. You may be right.
That's why you have to fill out it. You have to fill out a sheet, Luigi. You have to fill out five of them and put all the different combinations.
Then
your head's going to blow up, and then you think you're going to win a lot of money, and then your teams all lose in the first round, and by Sunday night you're ripping up this piece of shit and saying, why did I waste my time when I don't know one single player, one single team, one single coach? I don't even know where they're playing or any of that stuff.
Jameer Nelson's year at St. Joe's when they made that run.
Yep.
That was the best bracket I ever had and the worst at the same time. I was perfect up until the Sweet 16 and then couldn't win a game for love or money.
Well, we'll talk about that tomorrow. Because Phil Martelli, that team, because St. Joe's had a team back in the 80s that went pretty deep. They shocked DePaul, and DePaul was really, really good.
Yep.
But that was way before Phil Martelli. But you're right. The two guards that St. Joe's had that year when they made the deep run, they were first-round NBA draft picks, man. So he had the best backcourt in America back in, 2003 or 4, back in that era.
Yeah, that was Jameer Nelson and LeBron James' dad.
Exactly right.
I mean, good old Delonte West, man. It's a good thing for Delonte West.
It's about damn time.
He went through a really bad time, and actually he got himself together and he started
I mean, nobody wants to joke about that stuff, but if you can bang LeBron James' mom, then you were more than just a great basketball player. You know what I'm saying? you get a piece of that action.
Yeah. You know? I mean, hey, listen, Tone. Hey, listen, a few can bang the goat, but not many can bang the shepherd. You know what I'm saying?
You're damn right, man. By the way, we have breaking news right now from the high-speed NFL wire, Louise. This is just coming in right now. This is not bullshit. This is real deal. Because, yes, you thought just when you thought it was calming down in the National Football League, they still suck us back in today. Because, ladies and gentlemen, one and done. Remember Chase Young when they traded him from the Washington Commanders out there to the San Francisco 49ers, remember?
Yeah, he's unbelievable player.
He go. He go. Whoa. Chase Young plans to sign a one-year, fully guaranteed $13 million deal with the New Orleans Saints. How about that?
Wait a minute. You're telling me one of the premier pass rushers in the league, who's only about 25 years old, literally is taking a one-year deal?
I don't understand it. And if you're the 49ers, I mean, that was the strength of your team.
Yeah, that defensive line is what got you to that Super Bowl. I don't know. I don't know. That doesn't make any sense. I can't understand. Is this a cap saving thing for San Fran?
I don't know. I only see that the Saints, that Adam Schefter, all the reliable people are reporting on it. The Saints are signing free agent defensive end Chase Young, and so that's a big addition there. But the fact that the 49ers only had him for 1 year, you know, and everybody was laughing at Washington. They were just getting rid of great players. Chase Young was the number two pick in the draft a few years ago.
Well, absolutely. Chase Young was the number two pick in the draft. Remember what he said? What's it called? When he saw Mike Tomlin, he said to Mike Tomlin, he said, "Why don't you draft me?" He goes, "We'll never suck bad enough for me to draft a guy like you."
Exactly. So next year, here's the Saints defensive line.
Cam
Jordan, Brian Brees, and Chase Young.
Yeah,
how about that?
That's going to be a problem. That's going to be a problem.
Absolutely.
I mean, luckily for everybody else, they have David Carr as their quarterback, so it'll suck. So that's good. But the defensive line is going to be really damn good. Him and Cam Jordan next to each other is going to be probably the best 1-2 in the league.
Now, remember, this past year with the 49ers, even though they made the run to the Super Bowl, he had 3.5 sacks in 12 games that he played after he went over from the 49ers, I mean from the Commanders. So, again, this guy's still a stud player.
Oh, yeah, but don't forget about the fact that, you know, that San Francisco 49ers defensive line was littered with Pro Bowl talent. You had Hargrave, you had Nick Bosa. Then you bring, I mean, those two guys alone. You know what I mean, Tom?
Yep.
So, you know, Chase Young was just I guess I hate to say it. He was just a luxury for them.
Well, he looked, this didn't come out of nowhere. I mean, he talked with the Lions, he talked with the Titans. So he was shopping around. And it was the New Orleans Saints that did the deal to them. Just do the deal.
Just do the deal. That's crazy, man. Wow. That's crazy.
And then the San Francisco Giants baseball team today with an outrageous story today. The first black female booth announcer or stadium announcer, Rennell, as we knew her out in the Bay Area, she was about to start her 25th year as the PA announcer for the San Francisco 49ers, and then suddenly out of nowhere, the 49ers have decided not to bring her back.
The San Francisco Giants?
The San Francisco, what did I say? I'm sorry. The San Francisco Giants baseball team. Yeah, the San Francisco Giants baseball team. And Rennell, who everybody knew in the Bay Area, was on the radio for a long time, and then became the first black female PA announcer in Major League Baseball. As her 25th year is about to start, they can't reach a contract agreement. I mean, how does that make the Niners look? It's not like she was making millions of dollars doing the PA.
No, that makes the Giants look really, really bad, Tony. And it makes them look bad in ways of, like, also with the public, because at 25 years, you're like an institution.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? That's basically, you know, God rest his soul, would have been like giving Harry Callis his walking papers. Like what? Like somebody like that for 25 years, she was.
Now remember, she's not the player. She's the PA announcer. That's like Dan Baker being told they don't need
him
anymore.
But still, she's a pioneer, right? Being the first black woman in Major League Baseball to be doing that.
Yeah.
She's an institution with the Giants, been there for 25 freaking years.
Exactly.
Well, over 25 years. How do you let somebody like that walk?
I don't know. I'm surprised. That shocks me because, you know, the Bay Area, very, very progressive. You know, the people there. Listen, you don't have to be progressive to give the Giants credit you know, for being the first baseball team, Major League Baseball team, to hire a black female PA announcer.
Well, you know, Tony, being progressive, it just flows.
Yes, it does. And flow, I think, is the only thing, good thing left with progressive. Although, I wouldn't. I mean, she looks good from far away, but I bet you, you know, I bet you she would or wouldn't. That's the big question. Flow from progressive, would or wouldn't?
Have.
Wait a minute, I gotta give you
you
a roaring
quick
round of
on
applause
that
for that, brother. That is just great, great stuff right there.
See, I needed to laugh. That's why I called you.
That's why we're here, man. It's all about laughing and having a good time, man. Are you having
goddamn
a good
right
time, man?
Always having a good time. We got like really pitbull up in here, man.
Now, what's going on now? The weather's nice out there, right? How's the weather up in Philly? Pretty good, right?
The weather has turned a little, Tony. It's a little colder out now than it was. It's dropped about 20 degrees.
What's the temperature now?
Days, but it's about 46.
You're not going to be able to take the when it gets to 50 in that area this time of the year, because tomorrow's the first day of spring. It was in the 70s, I guess, the last few days. People are out there with the flip flops and the tank tops and the shorts, and you should see what the chicks are wearing, man. I mean, they're out there all over the place. But now you got a situation where, you know, you're going to have everybody excited, and then the next day it's cold. But you know, before long, everybody will be out in the sunshine again, man. Like I am. We got the lot started. We're going to put dirt put on there in the next couple of days, man. You got to come down to break ground. You got to come down to break ground and break bread, break ground, and break wind. Those are the three breaks.
Because
these are the breaks.
The breaking wind you can do on your own.
Pick it up. That's my man Curtis Blow right there, Tom.
Absolutely, man. Absolutely.
That's what I was calling about, is because I wanted to give you some congrats on finally. It's about goddamn time that some ground is getting broken.
Well, I mean, we went Saturday morning. We went out to Home Depot, Lowe's. We bought the stake. We hammered it into the lot. You know, one of those big metal stakes that are aluminum.
Yeah.
And then you put a post in it. So it's only supporting a plastic box where you put all the paperwork for the, you know, for the contractors and for the inspectors to come and check it out. And then our dirt guy called us. Then we found the stakes on the lot, and we put some spikes in it. We went to Tractor Supply, checked out all the chickens, the baby chicks at Tractor Supply.
Were you riding a John Deere?
No. We went to Tractor Supply to look to get some stakes and stuff to put in the ground, because we had to find the spikes that the surveyors, when they do the lot, they put these metal spikes with the little numbers on them and put them into the ground. But we haven't moved the ground forever. Now I had the earth move under my feet, but that was a long time ago.
Right. I feel the earth
move under my feet. What's the rest of it, Robin?
Yeah. I feel the
sky coming in down. Anyway, it's enough of that crap. So we got action going on faster than I thought. So we got to keep it going, keep it continuing the same thing all the time, as Sammy Sosa once said.
Faster than you thought. It's only been 2 years. You know, that's
no,
fine.
3 years, but who's counting? 3 years.
This one's counting, right? That's amazing. So let me ask you a question, though, with the house. Like, because I saw when I was there, when I came down, you took me to the realtor's office, and you showed me like the floor model, the house, right? Like the spec house.
No, there is not a spec house of our house. There's one that's similar to ours, but
right,
I just
similar,
wanted to show
similar,
you what
similar,
it looked like when it was finished. But no, there's no other spec similar home like ours. Ours is absolutely engineered. It's not one of those, you know, blueprint boilerplate engineered houses. Everything is engineered differently. We move things around, so it's not a boilerplate you can buy. And you can buy a boilerplate for like $5,000 and build that house. And that's what a lot of builders do down here. They have all these lots, and they have a couple of designs, and then they know what materials they need. They know how many men they need to work. They know the whole process, and those things get built in like 6 months. But you know, in our process, because we have the seawall up, and now, you know, we're going to have the dirt put down. We have the lot staked out. So it's getting close. We're going to have the front end loader go in there and dig the trenches next week. We may have to go out. I may have to rent a trailer and go out there and do a show live from the scene. What do you think, Luigi?
Anybody have an RV that we can borrow for, you know, a little while? Just park it out
front?
Honestly,
I think it's a disaster, but I'm going to tell you it's a great idea, Tone. I think you should go through with it. I think everything's going to be fine. I think it'd be a great show. You should do it. I can see Robin right now screaming, nothing works. Nothing's working. I can see it now.
No, we have internet out there. We'll have the internet out there is better than it is here because they have fiber.
I'll tell you what. You do a show from that plot of land, I will come down there and do the show with you.
I'm ready, man. I'm ready.
You let me know. You give me 1 week advance. I will literally take Penny and I down there and do a week's worth of shows down there with you.
Joey B says, just do a show from the Port-a-John that the contractual will put on
yeah,
the
I got to rent. That's right. I got to rent a port. Now, we have a lot of choices on porta-potties. And they have great names down here.
Yes.
Duty Calls.
Yes,
yeah.
Duty Calls.
Duty Calls. D-O-O-D-I-E. Duty Calls.
Right.
There's so many of them. They're the best names. Just do a show from there. Yeah, well, Joey, what? A pool and pond. Pool and a pond. The pond will be good for you. What? What the hell is he calling?
I wish it was a guy named like Herman, because I would name my porta potty place Pee-wee. And Herman.
Oh, that's good, too.
That's good.
No, they have the best porta potty names down here.
Yeah, they have one, John to go.
John to go. John to go, please.
Right.
They have, let's see, what's one of the other ones? Funny.
Do they have a shitter's full?
Shitter's full? Yes, indeed. They got reliable toilets out here, and the shitter's going to be full.
Reliable toilet.
That's right. Let's see what else they
got. He said reliable toilet.
That's reliable. Not even, they don't even have the good names on
I
here,
know.
Robin.
There's a couple of them that we saw that I'm not seeing now all of a sudden.
They got the best names. I'm telling you, the best names. I know them. Oh, this one's cool. It looks like it's an arm reaching out. What's the name of that place there, Robin?
I don't want an arm reaching out of the port-a-potty, Gary. That's not good.
Hey, let me say this. Don't come a-knocking if that port-a-potty's rocking, bro.
Right.
There's port-a-jane, too, not port-a-john. You get it?
But duty calls is, I think, one of my favorites.
Yeah. What did the
port-a-potty say when it was tired?
What?
I'm white.
Oh.
Yeah, I know. I know.
But
I'm
proud.
I'm sorry. I fucked up. I'm sorry. Anyway. Before I go, I got I know it's 5:30 and you guys are about to get to a break, but what's up with Lily and Riddle, man? I haven't heard anything about them.
They're chilling like villains.
They love the sun.
Lily sits out in the window with clothes, but she loves that morning sun. I love the morning wood.
Oh, yeah. It's about the morning sun
and the morning dew and the morning wood, more importantly.
Well, the morning wood is something you need to make sure that happens every day. I mean, that's like...
What happens when it doesn't happen? What happens?
I'm like the Army. I raise the flag every morning. You know what I mean?
Exactly right, man.
All right, man. Get the hell out of here. I'll talk to you.
There he is, ladies and gentlemen. Put your hands together for the man, the myth, the legend himself. The great Luigi Curto. It's like a son to me. A son of a bitch. We're coming right back. More calls. Texts flowing in. And we'll get you up to date on all the stuff. Talk basketball, tournaments all set to go, football news, baseball news, hockey, anything you want. Whatever you want, we're going to bring it to you. Yo, stick around.
It was meant to be. Tony Bruno on the Tony Bruno Sports
on
Network.
On Paramount Mountain, the stakes get higher.
I can't get that thing up there. If it were a football, I'd be able to reach the top.
What about a football-shaped head? We throw the child.
Gutsy call, sir.
Smart thinking.
What? No, that's dumb thinking. He's not throwing, Arnold.
Throw him.
Throw him. Throw him. Throw him.
Hey, do you throw one in a muni? I don't
throw. What? You can't throw a child at a wall.
Lattimore, shut your face.
Shut me.
Unless you prefer to freeze to death.
I'm not gonna throw a kid.
Not built for the moment, I see. Fine. I'll throw him.
And Creed's here.
Watch and learn.
Dang, he's cool.
It's the fifth quarter, and we need a hole-in-one before the seventh inning stretch. Be brave.
Hike! Can you take me higher to a place where I might see? I just threw him higher.
Come on!
To a place where we won't freeze.
He just threw me high. I'm good.
So close.
How are we gonna get up there?
Now, if there were only someone made of pigskin.
Bingo.
Oh, dear.
Now back to the biggest sports network on the planet, the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
Yeah. I was listening to Simple Mind last night after we came back and I rested. God, those guys are so good. They're still touring. Did you know that?
Yeah, are they really?
Simple Mind is still touring. I don't think it's all the original members, but much like ELO, the lead singer is still the same.
Yeah.
So while you have Jeff Lynne, the lead singer of ELO, and then you have the lead singer of this great group, they had a bunch of hits.
They did.
Simple Minds. Who would have thought Simple Minds worked many years ago? Now if somebody calls you a simple mind, you're a moron, right? I love Simple Minds. What was your favorite Simple Minds song, Robin?
This one I really liked because I love The Breakfast Club. That was like
It's not about the songs that were movies.
I know, but this is you know, like I was in high school.
No, it's a great song. But they had a lot of hits. And you know where they're from, right, Robin?
I do not.
Scotland.
Are they Scottish?
Yeah, they're Scottish.
They're Scottish.
Scotland.
I did not know that.
Jim Kerr, that's the lead singer there. Great,
hey,
man.
Tony Bruno.
Yes.
We
Alive and Kicking is one of my favorites, too.
We have more phone calls.
Let's go to the phone, shall we?
We have Dean from Clearwater calling in with, I'm sure, more sports.
By the way, Simple Minds will be appearing in Amsterdam at the Ziggo Dome on Monday.
Let's go.
Where's the Ziggo Dome, Robin?
I think it's Rotterdam, but I'm not sure.
No, it says Amsterdam.
Amsterdam, okay.
It's a Ziggo Dome. Dean, what up? Hello?
Well, Mr. Bruno.
Yes, sir.
Hello?
Hello?
Can you hear me now?
Yes, good. Good.
Robin, congratulations on a shovel breaking on your ground. I'm so happy for you. That's awesome.
Oh,
it's about damn time.
And when you get down here, I'll have a shovel breaking right over your head, pal. You give me any shit.
Yeah, and Robin, do me a favor. Save those shovels. So when the house is built and you moved in, I will help you bury Tony in the backyard.
There we go.
There's not going to be any underground. I told you, when I die, I want to be on a funeral pyre. The one, of course, that the great Jim Morrison talks about. And our love will be a funeral pyre. Come on, baby, light my fire.
Now, Tony, yeah. I've seen you were ripping me on the chat when you were saying, pools, ponds, clubs, what the hell are you talking about? Tony, Joey B said, Tony, are you going to have a pool? And my reply was, Joey, he's going to have a pool and a pond. The pond will be good for you. What reference is that from a movie?
I don't remember. I'm not, I only remember a couple movies. I remember Spaceballs.
Caddyshack.
See, I don't remember. The only ones I know from Caddyshack are and Rodney Dangerfield saying, "Hey, everybody's going to get laid." You know, there's only a couple. I know all the Mel Brooks movies because they're outrageous, and I know a little bit of Caddyshack, but
when Bill Murray and Chevy Chase was in his home on the course, and he hit a golf ball astray. Murray asked him if he was going to, you know, he invited him over to his house as they were passing the bomb, and he said, "Do you have a pool over here?" And he said, "Yeah, I got a pool and a pond. The pond would be good for you."
See, I don't remember that. I don't remember.
Wow.
That.
Well, that's understandable. You're old.
To me, Spaceballs, there's great lines in Caddyshack. Don't get me wrong.
Oh, there's great lines in hundreds of movies.
But the Mel Brooks movies had all. the great lines in it. I mean, the entire movie, one line after another. You didn't have to wait like 15 minutes for the next zinger. I mean, they were constant. They just kept on coming, man.
And I told, and Joey B on the thing was saying, talking about your new neighbors and new friends and all this stuff. And I said, Joey, the good thing about Tony being so old, he meets new people every day.
Thank you very much, Dean. I love my neighbors. They love me. They came out. They were so excited.
You
when
did
we
that one over your
poster.
Head, I see.
Yeah, see, I don't know, because I don't do, you sit at home at night and watch all these stupid movies. I'm here trying to
that
build a damn
movie.
House.
That's just, that's talk about being old with a bad memory and you forgot who you met yesterday as your new neighbor.
I don't forget anything, pal. I got a mind like a, I got a brain like an iron trap. Is that the line? What, is that good or bad?
The irony is just hysterical on that.
See, when you can make fun of yourself first, if you can be self-deprecating, then everything
there
else is going to be fine. Most people are not self-deprecating.
Absolutely.
They're so thin-skinned that if you say something, you know, if you can't knock yourself first and make fun of yourself, then you shouldn't be able to knock anybody. You know what I mean?
Absolutely, brother. Did you see, I don't know if you noticed when, you know, you're talking sports and stuff, there was the Hobart Division III hockey goalie.
I didn't see
98
that. No.
Saves.
98 saves
in the game. Yeah, holy. It's the second most saves in a division in, you know, NCAA history, man. And they lost the damn game.
I did not see that. But that's not the Frozen Four. This is another hockey tournament, right?
No, it was Division III. You know, it was to go to the semifinals for the Division III. That's why Hobart, you know, they're no big program, but it was still
that.
Amazing that he hit.
Did they play with defensemen? Did the other team play with the whole bar to have a defenseman in front of them? Or did they just let him shoot from everywhere?
No, I think there was a couple OTs. Had to be.
98
had
shots.
Be overtime, right? You had 90 shots. 90 shots up. Just three.
Did you finish your bathroom, Dean? Is it done?
Actually, Tony, I'm about 99% there, baby. I just painted all the trim today, man. It's winding down. My job is about done. I'm just waiting on the cabinets that, you know, that had to be made to vanity. But other than that, yeah, I'm good, bro. So you can come up and use my shower, or I can run. See, you know, it's new. Robin might need some help in there, so I can run it by her first.
Yeah, that's
very sweet of you. Very sweet of you.
Well, we missed you. We came up there. We went to Anthony's Coal Fired Pizza. Had a great time. Great meal. It was awesome. Awesome. But your girl wasn't there. She wasn't there.
What?
Your waitress friend was not there.
She no longer. No, she no longer works on Saturday nights. We were told.
Oh, that can't be true.
No, that's
got to be out of town. She worked.
Yeah, yeah. She wasn't. She wasn't there. She didn't work that night. But that's okay.
Yeah, she works every weekend. That's when the money's to be made in most restaurants. So.
Damn right.
Well, the wife is yelling in from the kitchen. She was off last Saturday.
Oh,
see,
okay.
So you have to ask your wife for correct information because you're always wrong, Dean. And we don't tolerate that kind of misinformation on this show.
I'm not wrong. She works on weekends. She just happened to be off on that Saturday, brother.
Unbelievable, man.
Anyway,
who do you like tonight? You like the Boston Celtics tonight, laying 16 points as they continue to beat down the rest of.
Yeah, they've been beating everybody by an average of 15 points a game. It's just, this is crazy.
And Detroit's coming off Detroit's coming off one of those gut-wrenching losses last night. Did you see that final shot in the game where Detroit had the ball, Cunningham shot it, missed it, and then no timeout, Miami gets the ball, comes down, and went way outside beyond the three-point, nothing but net, and it was good. And the poor Pistons lose again.
Well, they could use another. They're obviously going to get a number one draft pick. So, I mean, they got a couple. That Cade Cunningham's pretty awesome.
Yeah,
well,
they're not mailing it in. They're trying hard. And that's all that's all fans want to see. Like, when the Sixers were tanking, they didn't have any good players. So it wasn't about trying hard. They had a G League or D League team. At least the Pistons, you're right, have some legitimate talent out there on the floor. And I'm sure that organization wants to build. They don't want to suck every year.
Yeah, no, I think between what the young kids they got and what they're going to have with another great draft pick, obviously, I think they'll turn it around the next couple of years.
I do, too.
I mean, when's the last time they won a championship?
No, I mean, Detroit's a great sports city, and I think the Pistons fans, they'll be there, you know, and I remember Detroit basketball, the PA guy in that building was rocking in Detroit, man, rocking.
Yes, it was.
Did you watch Scottie Scheffler at all? Did you watch Scottie Scheffler, the unbelievable shots he was making this past weekend at the Players Championship?
Tony, I sent you my wager on Hard Rock's bet I made when he started coming back in the last round, and he was like one off the lead. I went on Hard Rock's bet and placed a little wager on him to win the tournament. And to all the bullets he dodged on the last four holes with the last five players was just out of this world. It wasn't for a lot of money, but I don't care if you were betting $5,000 or $50. I mean, you want to win your wager. So, I mean, I was like on the edge of my seat saying, oh, miss.
So what did you get? What were the odds then when he finally started? Because he was, I said after the first round, he was eight shots back.
Yeah, yesterday, like live in the, like in the 10th hole, I forget. It was somewhere on the 10th hole, I bet, I forget. But he was plus 175.
Yeah, that's not bad. It's almost 2-1.
No, it's any win's a win, right? Anytime you can cash a ticket, it's a good thing.
Now, are you filling out your stinking brackets?
I'm not there because people are winning. No, I'm not filling out a bracket. I'm in a pool. It's $100 a square. Obviously, 100 people, and you just get the winning team score and the losing team score. You get the last digit. So if it's 35, 34, then you. It's 4 and 5, and you got to line up your numbers. So, I mean, it's just that's what I do with it. I'm in a bracket.
By the way, Joey B goes, LMAO, Dean calls in, and the wife talks to Tony and Robin from the background. LOL. Epic.
And you know her. She's really kind of calm, reserved, and quiet.
Yes. That's what happens. You piss your wife off, and then she has to take it out on you on this show so people can hear what a crumb creep coward you are.
So you getting excited to come up and see Book of Omens, Tony?
Yes.
When? Oh, what date is that? What's the date? I didn't write it on the calendar.
Don't worry. I promise you, Robin has that date open on the calendar for you.
I have it right here. It's not written down. What's the date? Let me write it down right now.
It is April.
What is it, Robin?
I think
April 19th.
19th or 20th?
I think it's the 20th.
20th.
That's a Saturday night?
Yeah, it's April the 20th.
Yes, sir.
I'm going to write down bomb. So B-O-M, would you like... bomb.
So are we going? No, it's going to be fantastic. Robin
has Book of Mormons.
Robin
B-O-M. Hello? Yes. B-O-M, Book of Mormons. What's the matter with you?
Oh, I thought you said something else.
Bomb. I said bomb.
So would you like me to make some reservations for dinner that night?
That would be lovely.
My reservations are coming up there to see the Book of Mormon.
I cannot wait until after
the show.
I don't
like making fun of religions.
Oh.
Tony, the other day, a couple days ago on the show, you were like getting off on some Broadway show, like musical tune. And I put in the chat that I said, oh, Tony, you're getting yourself primed up. You're going to love our Broadway show we're going to go see.
No, what
I mean,
was the Broadway song that I played?
Broadway songs. I forget what it was. I mean,
yeah, it was Robin Hood Men in Tights. That's the last musical I saw, and it has the greatest song in musical history, which is We're Men in Tights. That's what I was singing.
Tony,
now, if they did a live version of Robin Hood Men in Tights on the stage, I would go see it.
There's many great shows.
I know.
You
I cannot see. Wait I mean, until after this show is over, though, where he does a major mea culpa and goes, wow, that was a really great show.
The only live shows I go see is a woman on a man on a circular turntable, and I put a quarter in, and then the screen goes up. That's the only live shows I go and see.
Well, when we go to New Orleans next year for the Super Bowl, you will be able to see that right there on
Bourbon Street, baby. Bourbon Street. Basin Street.
I better get a damn invite to New Orleans with you guys. You better book me a room.
I'll book you a room on the bayou. I'll get you down there and I'll get some damn alligators in the moat and I'll put you right outside in a tiny home, right there on the bayou in the 9th ward.
Says the guy who's staying at my house in about 25 days. Robin, you'll be in the house. He'll be out in a tent in the backyard.
It's bullshit, man. How dare you?
Thank you for checking in, Dean.
All right, now get out.
Anyway, guys, good to hear from you, Robin.
Thank you, Dean.
Bye, Dean.
Be careful out there. By the way, Bill Gladney down there in North Carolina and his wife, they're the ones that got us tickets to the ELO show.
We need to call him. You know why?
Why?
He has been working with a medium and has discovered his...
A psychic medium?
A psychic medium, and he discovered that he has... psychic abilities himself and has been learning how to get in touch, so we could use him as a medium now.
For what? To find out if our lot's going to be built? There's no ghosts on our lot.
I did an EMF test.
You
could talk to our parents. You could talk to your mom and dad.
I want to talk to my subcontractor so I get my damn house built.
Well, hopefully he's not dead.
My dead parents aren't going to help me right now.
Well,
I'd love to talk to my mom. You know what I'm saying?
So we need to call Bill Gladney, his lovely wife.
Absolutely. Down there in North Carolina. You know what I'm saying? So let me repeat again. If you missed the top stories, the big story in football today is that Chase Young, the former number two overall pick for the Washington Commanders just a few years back, who was traded to the San Francisco 49ers early last season to help solidify that defensive line with the 49ers, is now one and done. We knew he was a free agent. We knew he talked to the Detroit Lions. He talked to several teams. But today he has agreed to join the New Orleans Saints on the defensive line. So Chase Young goes from Washington to San Francisco in the Super Bowl and now goes to New Orleans. A big, big free agent signing announced today. The Cowboys are reducing Dak's cap hit. Dak Prescott, they're working on a deal. Final year of his contract. They're supposedly going to work on it all year. But that doesn't sound like Jerry Jones has any immediate urgency to get Dak's deal done and say that fast five times. But today, what they did is they reduced the number $5 million, and they're going to give him a $5 million signing bonus, which doesn't count against the cap, but it will reduce the cap $4 million. So now he'll only hit $55 million, and Dallas will still be $55 million, you know, with dead money. But not dead money. He's going to play. So anyway, they're trying to get the numbers lower because they need to sign players. And not just Dak, but they need to sign CeeDee Lamb, you know, and another one of their superstar players, their defensive superstar, who's still unsigned for a long-term deal. So Dallas has some problems. I mean, as good as they were, and many people picked them to win the Super Bowl last year, I'm not saying they're going to suck. I'm just saying they've got a lot of players that are not happy, and they have to get those deals done. Because I don't know what's going to happen. I mean, Cowboy fans aren't happy. The NFL is surprised. And so we'll see what happens over the next couple of weeks with the Dallas Cowboys. We mentioned the new stadium. It's not a new stadium. They're going to have the old stadium out in Arizona, which is named after State Farm Insurance. They're going to put luxury casitas in the end zone so that fans can have a more pleasurable and expensive option when they can't see the game from the end zone seats because the players are standing in. No, you can actually see it there because nobody stands in front of those areas. It's the sidelines when you're down on the lowest level and then you have to look over all the players on the sideline and the coaches and the equipment and all that other stuff. So anyway, Antonio Gibson, this is according to Mike Reese, ESPN NFL Nation reporter covering the Patriots up there. He says Antonio Gibson on his first meeting with Gerard Mayo, quote, "Definitely a different vibe from a head coach just from the day I met him. It sounded like he was talking to one of the guys. I feel like that's something that might be positive in the locker room for him to be, for him to relate and communicate like that and an understanding of both sides of it. He also showed my daughter a hell of a time, brought her up into the office, treated her with love. I appreciate that for sure, especially the first time meeting him." So obviously Antonio Gibson, who was a great player for the Washington Commanders, obviously didn't feel that way, you know, about the coaching staff that he left behind, and they're gone now. And so that's what happens. Players want to relate to younger coaches now.
Yeah.
With the exception of the Bill Belichicks, and now Andy Reid, who's an older coach, he's still respected despite him being old. You know why he's respected? Because his teams win every year, and his organization puts together players who continue to win. But when you're the Patriots, you know, when you're the Washington Commanders and you've sucked for a long, long time, and you got a stud player like Antonio Gibson, and he's available to go elsewhere, and he does, and then he's going to a team that's been bad and doesn't have a franchise quarterback, and he's still impressed with the head coach because the head coach can relate to him, you know, that's a good sign if you're the New England Patriots and their fan base, because that's all fans want. And the tax situation in Massachusetts would also help. You know, because obviously they charge a lot in New Jersey, by the way, getting ripped today too, as apparently the taxation situation sensation up there in New Jersey is really, really bad, Robin. And we know that having a lot of players, who are not happy with paying taxes in New Jersey.
No, they
are
not.
Or in California, for that matter.
No. Hey, Tony.
Yes.
Before the show ends, let's go to our text line where we still have lots of texts coming through. Here is one from area code 352 as well. Area code 352, love your show. Started listening 20 years ago on WDAE.
The sports animal in Tampa with some of the greatest people ever assembled. And so many of my friends there are no longer with us. You know, the great.
I know.
The two great hosts who were the midday big guys dog. In the afternoon. The big dog, Steve Dooming, who passed away
a couple
years
ago. Oh, that
was Bob
in Tampa, by the way.
Bob in Tampa, Bob. Great friends. And, of course, Chris Thomas, who was there in the morning, afternoons, middays, actually. Another guy who was on News Channel 8. And he did a lot of stuff when he was on the air that he could never do today. And that's why I love him, because he was a guy that just had fun with life, enjoyed it every single day, and didn't really, you know, didn't have people bother him, you know. I'm telling you, the stuff he would say and the drops he would play on his show would never, ever go in today's radio. So I'm glad I got to work with great guys like Steve Dumig and Chris Thomas and all the other great people on all the radio stations and networks that I've been to in my years. So anyway, that's what's going on out there. But we love the Tampa Bay area. Love it, love it, love it. Now, by the way, this is breaking news now. The Supreme Court... This is just in, according to CNN, the Supreme Court has indefinitely blocked Texas from enforcing immigration law. So the Supreme Court has now stepped in again into a state's right to enforce their borders. And, you know, I think that they should ignore federal law. I mean, the federal government ignores laws. They lose Supreme Court decisions and they just do whatever they want anyway.
Well, but if somebody, if a state ignores federal law, then that opens the door to other states ignoring other federal law.
No, Robin, the point is the Supreme Court rules on federal law. So the bottom line is the Supreme Court has ruled on a lot of laws, and Washington has ignored Supreme Court decisions that went against the administration in power. So now the administration in power obviously wants the borders to stay open, and then they claim they don't. So why would the Supreme Court block Texas from enforcing their borders?
It is.
I don't understand that. I thought that's why we have states, don't we? I learned growing up in political science and journalism that the states have a right. That's why they're individual states that absolutely have a right to protect their borders. So I don't understand it. I just don't understand how some people can decide that the Supreme Court rulings stand and other people can decide that we're going to ignore what the Supreme Court says. Isn't it the highest court in the land? But to me, it's about each state's rights to protect their citizenry.
Well, there's a lot of stuff that just
I know. And again, this is not a political statement. This is just understanding law. And
there's a lot of stuff that just doesn't make sense.
It doesn't. That's all I'm saying. It doesn't make any sense when you see what's going on. People just walking across. I mean, if the border was secure, and they're not admitting it, and they don't want to admit it. So that's the sad thing. We need to protect our own citizens. I mean, I mentioned earlier, they have a wall in the Dominican Republic to keep Haitians from coming across.
I know.
And it runs like forever.
No, but it's okay for walls in other countries, but not in here.
Exactly.
What the Fauci, who is in... I think in or close to New Orleans, stoked about Chase Young coming to the Saints. I might actually keep my season tickets this year.
That's right. You won't have to bring the paper bags out again. By the way, I want to thank everybody for checking in. Bleacher Brothers coming up at 8 o'clock tonight,
yes.
Right? We'll be back tomorrow. Phil Martelli and a whole bunch more.
Tomorrow morning, 7 a.m.
Pete Sheppard Show. Exactly right. And we thank you for listening and watching to Tony Bruno Show. God bless. Don't drink and drive. Don't text and drive. And God bless America. It is still the greatest country in the universe, as far as we know. I know it's the greatest country on earth. The universe, we'll deal with that later. Good night, everybody.
listening to Tony Bruno Sports Network. Tony didn't invent sports radio. He perfected it.
This knife has a straight edge on it, so it's very easy. And maybe in our world here, there lives a happy little mountain.